Okay. Hey, Ma. No. No, you're not on live. I have you on mute. What? Yeah, you can call me back later, but what are you up to? Oh, yo, mute your YouTube, Jokerfish.
Oh, sorry about that. Wait, do I have you?
That's fine. So, what are you up to, though? Oh, okay. All right, well, I'll talk to you later, then. All right, let's go. First, let me tell you, I found my first cousin, Mark Falkenbach, last night.
I heard that, man.
Mark Falkenbach, my first cousin, dad's brother, or dad's, his brother is Bob. Yeah, so that's fucking hilarious. I was totally mind blown. I'll tell dad about that. He'll be too.
Yeah, that's crazy, man. I'm trying to shut.
I think he's in Kansas City or something, but I'll call dad later and let him know what the fuck happened, and yeah, I'll talk to you later, okay, Ma? All right, bye bye. This shit's too funny. All right, so we're live.
And we're back.
All right, everybody, we're here. I would like you to like and share. I'm fucking chilling here with Jokerfish.
Cheers.
Of the Drunk News Network, and I'll link that after I'm done with this. I should have already done that, but I'll do that afterwards. I just had some breakfast. I read an article last night that said, "Take yourself, spend some alone time with yourself. Get used to, you know, your aloneness, and go, take yourself on a date tomorrow."
Oh, nice.
And so I knew that we were gonna have our talk. So, and I was gonna have a day drink and a talk, and it's not just a normal talk here, folks. We're gonna go deep down the rabbit hole. I was up really late. I couldn't sleep that well. I went to bed around like 4 or 5 in the morning, but oh yeah, I couldn't sleep that well, I guess, because I got super nostalgic and weirded out that I found my fucking cousin last night.
Yeah.
And then he was telling me about my brother and shit like that, and that totally caught me off guard. And I found out family secrets and stuff, and I love that. And it's so funny that Bob is the one who did it for me. Praise Bob. And I'll get into that in a bit, but I just wanted to thank Jokerfish for coming on here, and thank you guys for tuning in. If you could like and share this, that would be badass. And I'm going to go – let's see here. I'm going to check out the order of the things that I said we were going to talk about, which was it says talking subjects include in order, and this is a perfect way to start off with, is the dark night of the soul. And I think that's what Jokerfish is possibly in the middle of, or just getting out of.
Just coming out.
I wouldn't know, but
just coming out.
And so the first topic is the dark night of the soul, Chapel Perilous, as Robert Anton Wilson coined the term, and crossing the river of tears, which I heard Jim Carrey say on a recent interview I was watching. And so I think that's a good, let's just put it this way. Not everyone needs to go through the dark night of the soul. There's all these fucking pseudo spiritual or pseudo punk people that think they need, like, oh, I gotta put myself through this fucking hardship and torture myself and suffer and misery and pain and say it's just I'm letting you know personally, you don't have to do that to yourself. You don't need to go through the dark night of the soul to be an intelligent person or a humble person or a relaxed person. You don't need to do that to yourself. You don't need to go through that experience to achieve anything. It doesn't mean anything if you've done it. It just means that that's what you had to do. It's what happened. Either it's what happened to you unconsciously, it just happened, or you fucking deliberately made the choice. I'm gonna put myself through this, and then you realize 5 or 10 years later, holy shit, I remember when I said that like 5 or 10 years ago that I was gonna put myself through the dark night of the soul, and now that I'm in it, I gotta get the fuck out of this. And some people don't ever get the fuck out of that hole. And they lose themselves for the rest of their lives in madness and in complete misery. And so, yeah. What do you got to say about that, man?
Well, I just know that the dark brooding rebel, leave that for the movies. You know, the dark brooding guy or girl sitting there and you know, that's just for the movies. Live your life better than that. I understand that there's traumas in life, that there's, you know, whether it's you lose a member, a friend, you lose a job, you're in a bad situation, whether it be, you know, about money or these stupid pressures that the outside world puts on us. Like, money's a big one. A lot of people get really, really dark over they want to make more money or they want to have a job and a certain place in life. Well, there's a lot of work involved in, you know, like if you want to be a doctor, there's a lot of work in becoming a doctor. If you want to be a janitor, there's still a lot of work that you have to do to become a good janitor. I mean, it's not just about sweeping and now I've never been a doctor, but I've been a janitor. I've been a construction worker. I've cut hair, and I've played in a rock and roll band. And, one thing about the rock and roll band was, you know, it does get frustrating and it does get lonely sometimes because, you know, you'll be out in a van with five guys. And then after a while, you know, I didn't really get along with the guys I was with. So I had to purposely come out of myself and not be miserable and say, I'm just going to get along with these guys no matter what, you know, I'm just going to have fun and you know, who cares about any personal differences we have like that bring me down. I've been in mental hospitals and I've seen people, they just can't get over one specific incident in their life. And it just drags them down and down and down. And one thing that I think you really have to do is really rely on yourself and other people around you. I mean, you have to get a good support system around you, whether it be family, whether it be friends, whether it be even, you know, I mean, I remember I had a pen from Japan. Nowadays, you could just talk to people like online, be friends with people. That can really bring you out, because the dark spot I was going through was a lost relationship. You know, my medication it was like a little off balance, and it was really starting to turn my head to a dark place. And I really had to reach out to people to bring me up. And I luckily have a really good support group. But like you said, you don't have to go through that. If you find yourself, you know, hitting that, you know, the skids and it's okay to cry. It's okay but you let that stuff out. And there are people out there that will help you through it, whether, you know, they know it or not. I mean, I like to say, I'm not going to say God, but I like to say there is out the universe, the cosmos, the lights above us will put people in your life. They will just put people life, and whether those people know it or not, they're helping you beyond what you think you're capable of, what you think, you know, your sadness is. So I just, you know, it's really, it's, and I know with a lot of artists, like, you know, and when Jim Carrey says something like that, because a lot of, you know, the tortured artist, and you see these, the master painters, who is it? Van Gogh. I mean, this guy was tortured. But if you think about it, like, you know, who knows why? Could it be a chemical imbalance? Could it be a drug addiction? Could it be, you know, just he wanted to be somewhere where he couldn't be? And I'm fascinated by him, just because he was such a tortured soul. But, you know, I don't.
Van Gogh?
Yeah.
I don't know much about him.
Yeah, he, I think I'm saying there, that's Vincent Van Gogh. He's got a museum.
You mean is it Van Gogh or is it Salvador Dali?
No, I'm talking about Van Gogh. You know, he's the guy who supposedly cut off his ear and sent it to, like, he loved somebody and he cut off his ear because he loved her so much.
But then,
you know, some people are saying, well, that could have been, like, he might have had, like, a mental thing where he was hearing, like, I don't know if anybody's out there's ever had auditory hallucinations or voices in their head, but, you know, they're not sure of, like, that's the story. That's the romantic story. He cut his ear off the girl.
Well, what's his face? Plato had a demon. It was spelled with an A, or D-A-E, Damon, something was pronounced differently. And actually, back then, they thought it was a good thing. Because this demon gave him all of his good ideas.
All of his thoughts and philosophies.
It's such a strange thing now, like when you say, well, to other people, and especially in a large group, oh, do you guys talk to yourselves? Do you guys talk to yourselves? What do you mean, Dan? Oh, I mean, like, do you have a dual conversation in your head, like where one voice says something randomly, and you're like, what the fuck? And then you're literally commentating on what you just thought, and you're almost like grossed out or disgusted or ashamed of yourself that the thought even came up. And I mean, that happens to me maybe like once a day, maybe. It happens. And sometimes I would even shake my head physically, where I would think the thought, and I would be so fucking ashamed of myself that I would go, ugh, like, ugh.
Yeah.
Like, why, you know, and then I'm like, I'm just so analytical with my thoughts, just like what you're saying, that I have that thought that comes up spontaneously, but then, like, after all this Zen reading that I've been doing, it's just like the thoughts are, these thoughts that come up are just thoughts. They're not you.
Right.
Not what you feel and what you mean. It's not what you, it's like the wind passing by. And it's like, you just have to let it pass by. It's a fucking wind.
Right.
Don't identify with it. Don't judge yourself. Don't feel guilty or shameful. It happens, you know? And I know everyone in listening has done the same thing.
But we've been exposed to things that we don't even know we've been exposed to. Like when you're a kid, you might have been like a little baby, and a conversation might have happened, and it still goes into your head. You might not know it because you're a little baby, or maybe you're a 10-year-old kid, and your parents are watching a crazy movie in the other room, and you're hearing, and you're in your bedroom, and you're hearing stuff, and you don't even really know that this stuff is coming in. And then it kind of reminded me of what you're saying, like the angel and the devil on your shoulder, where the devil's going, do this, and the angel's like, no, don't do that. But you know, there's so much we're exposed to. Like, I never liked the group Led Zeppelin. They were like big rock stars, and I was like, they're too fancy. And I would play with my buddy. He's like, hey man, that really sounded like Zeppelin. And I'm like, well, I don't know how. I never listened to him, but I was exposed to it, so it did filter into my brain. And then just sometimes you might even hear a conversation on the bus, and you're not even paying attention, but the words are going in there. And then all of a sudden, like in your subconscious, in the part of the brain where we don't really, you know, we can't really tap into, will release these, you know, things that have just come into our
chemicals.
Consciousness. Yeah. and it's just come into our consciousness.
I noticed like those thoughts that you're talking about, and they, like you just said, they come into your fucking brain and they induce chemical reactions, and those chemical reactions induce physiological reactions, which is body, like adrenaline starts to, we start to sweat, you fucking, you gotta stretch your neck, you're like, oh shit, you're like, your stomach feels tense and your heart starts to beat. Like, these are, I've been through all of this. Another example is, okay, you'll be sitting there and you'll like see someone do something, and or like you said, hear them say something, and your thoughts will come in immediately and you'll just judge them. You're just right. Like, oh, that's judgments. Yeah. And those are, like, again, those aren't your thoughts. Again, you may be, it's a hallucination. Your brain is creating the hallucination of reality. And, right. And this is, so those judgments that suddenly come up that you think are you when you're listening to other people or when you see somebody do something, that's just the wind. That's just you. You don't gotta identify with it, and you can change your thoughts.
Right.
And like, you, instead of like, I catch myself like, you know, like, and but then I'll go, I'll change it. I'll go, all right. You know, even a fake smile will induce chemicals. Your brain doesn't know the difference between you know, what's real and what's not. It'll create serotonin and dopamine, which are chemicals that produce, and peptides, which produce happiness. Those chemicals that will create happiness, and then like your neurons will start to talk to one another, and then create connections, and stop being so distant. And then those thoughts will pass easily, and the judgments will subside, and you'll just be chilling with your buddy, talking about it, and helping other people go through their own stuff. And that's how, you know, you get out of the dark night and cross the river of tears. I think that's it.
I got an example of something like, say you go over to your friend's house for like a little gathering or something, and there's somebody you don't know, and you look at that person, you're like, I don't like this person. You don't know them. They might have, you know, but you don't know them at all. And you're just like, I don't like this guy. But then all of a sudden you start talking and you get to know him. You're like, wow, what a great guy this guy is. You know, but just that initial, you know, there's something that comes into your brain that says, well, I don't like this guy. You know, then you're like, wait a minute, this guy's really, you know, he's really smart. Or, you know, he's really a big Yankee fan or something, which they're in the playoffs tonight. Yep. And I've had that a lot of times where someone would come in and kind of just, you know, be like jerk or something, and but then it turns out that, you know, it might have been, you know, if somebody might be a little nervous, like, you know, because people react different to, you know, in situations, you know, some people overcompensate, and like, you know, I've been around a lot of people that were just plain douchebags. I mean, they were awful people, but it's, they had no self-confidence, nothing. They were just so shot, and they had to overcompensate by being a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
You know, I've been around a few people like that, and you're just like, come on, man. You know, just work it out. You know, there's
even just tell them to fucking relax a little bit, and like that'll piss them off. It's like this isn't a Sopranos episode. You don't need to fucking get angry when I tell you to fucking relax, dude. Like, what do you mean? I'm gonna fucking bash your head in. Like, no, dude. That's the whole thing. I just told you to relax, and you want to bash my head in, dude. Like, dude, come on, man. Like, that's the whole thing. So hold on. Let me read some of these. I want to talk some things with you, like Tom Petty and Orson Welles.
Right on.
And, because I know you, I mean, you probably know a fuck ton more about Tom Petty than I do.
Yeah, they actually, you know, when Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers first started playing, they would play with like the Ramones, and they were kind of thrown into not the punk rock, but, you know, like the new wave kind of music, you know, Talking Heads. And, you know, I saw a flyer somebody put up, you know, like RIP, as this New York hardcore page I'm on, it said, you know, RIP Tom Petty. Headliner was the Ramones, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and then there was another, like, kind of, you know, new wave band. And you wouldn't think that Tom Petty would ever have played with the Ramones. So I just thought that was, you know.
Yeah, that's pretty badass. Yeah, seriously. Did you ever see that interview with Tom Petty where he admits that he sold his soul to pretty much Lucifer?
Yeah.
The devil?
Yeah. I saw him. And then I saw one with Bob Dylan where he said that too.
Oh yeah. Well, maybe that was Bob Dylan. Actually, I'm thinking of Bob Dylan, but I'll have to check the Tom Petty one. I take that back. But yeah, I think that was Bob Dylan who said what I just said. So I take that back, and I'll have to look into the Tom.
Yeah, he
Petty
said
thing.
It right on camera. He goes, "I sold," because even people said they're like, you know, Bob Dylan wasn't even like he was just kind of regular. He left like Minnesota, wherever he was from, and they said when he came back, he was unbelievable. So and he goes, yeah, I went and sold my soul. So you're like, what? Are you joking? Or is, you know?
Yeah, the interviewer's like, what do you mean? He's like, you know, I sold my soul to the big guy.
Yeah.
And the interviewer's like, to the big guy. He's like, God? And he's like, no. The other, not that one. The other one. And it was, I was like, what the fuck? I'm like, that was fucking weird.
Yeah, just like random, you know.
And how many fucking, I mean, you can go online and you can type in celebrities saying I sold my soul to the devil, and it'll give you'll watch an hour long video of 100 or 1,000, like realistically, like literally like 150 different celebrities throughout time saying that.
Well, even Jim Carrey, he plays around a lot with that, you know, the whole Illuminati, and like he'll kind of like,
yes, he does
dance the line with that stuff. And because Jim, I think Jim Carrey's a fucking genius. But he, you know, and you don't know if he's being serious or if he's joking, and it's just kind of like he's like a wink and a nod. But you know, it's throw up the sign, and you know, it's just he. Yeah, some of these people, I'm sure, have so much fucking they could tell you.
Some conspiracy theorists say that Jim Carrey is the high priestess of the, the Illuminatus, and that's why they give him. That's why he's allowed to say everything, because he's like the main dude,
and he's a Canadian.
But so let's get back on topic here. So I want to tell you a quick story about what happened to me. I want to tell you a quick story of me, how I met my first cousin last night.
Oh yeah,
through the Church of the Sub Jesus. All right, so let me see. Let me show you the. I'll show you the conversation. Here you go. You'll enjoy this. So here's the conversation. Oh, and I want to sing a song real quick first. I want to sing a Tom Petty song. Hold on, how about this one? I'm going to sing it for Jokerfish and all of you listening. How about this? It's good to be king, if it's just for a while, to be there in velvet, yeah, to give them a smile. It's good to get high, and never come down. It's good to be king of your own little town. It's good to be king and have your own way. Get a feeling of peace at the end of the day. And when your bulldog barks and your canary sings, you're out there with winners. Yeah, it's good to be king. It's good to be king and you have your own world. It helps to make friends. It's good to meet girls. A sweet little queen who can't run away. It's good to be king, whatever it pays. That's fucking great, dude. I heard that song, dude. My mind was fucking blown. I haven't listened to it in 10 years, and
yeah,
it's just like, it's so fucking relevant, and I think of like the art of war, and how it says like the worst people try to become kings, like like the people who want to be king and the people who want to be emperor are the worst, like, subjectively or relatively evil people. Like, they're just intrinsically evil. Like, if you want to be king and emperor of the fucking world, is there really two different ways? Like, could you just want to be king and help everyone and actually be a good king? But that is that the illusion? Like, yeah. I'll be the good king. I promise, okay? Just let me be king and I'll help everyone, okay? I promise. You see the contradiction there's a paradox there. There's a you can't trick the universe.
Right.
Okay? Like, I'm not saying that to you I'm just saying I've tried to trick the universe. You can't, like, you can lie to everyone, you can lie to yourself and be delusional, but the universe is always, it knows your intentions and your authenticity. You can't trick the universe. You can be the best actor possible, but you're going to get a pie in your face one day.
Yeah, at the end of the day. Pie. Yeah, like at the end of the day, something, you know. And I really believe that. I really believe that. I'm not going to say that there's a plan, like, the, you know, that everybody's born and there's a plan for them, because we choose our own path and everything. But, you know, I do believe that, whether it be called karma, whether it be called whatever, you will have to answer for what you have done, whether good or bad. You know, like you see people that, you know, oh, well, you know, if I get elected president, vote for me and I'll do this. And those guys never help. Fucking Donald Trump's giving people paper towels and pouring. What the fuck are people in a fucking country or, you know, like territory of Puerto Rico going to do with paper towels right now? They don't have anything and they're just giving them paper towels. Like, the fuck is that?
Kobe. Well, I mean, to defend Donald Trump, because I like to be the devil's advocate, it looks like they're having a good time, and you know, I don't want to reveal my card too much, but I almost don't want to trigger people, but
you can't help yourself.
It's just it's like that voice that we were talking about earlier. It's like, come on, just say it, you asshole. hold on a sec. I'm reading. You bring it out. I said, you're such a Facebook fake. It's amazing. To one of my good friends, you bring it out of me, especially when you insult my best friend. And there's nothing wrong with curiosity. Okay, good. At least she wasn't a fucking dick. So let's see here. So I'm closing this off. Oh, I was going to share this hangout with this Facebook group. So I'm going to share this hangout with the Facebook group real quick. I'm going to check out the comments, peek in, say hello. It's good to be king.
You know, what amazing. It's like, you know, I kind of took Tom Petty for granted my whole life, because he was always putting out great music and he was always there. You know, and at every record he put out had great stuff on it. Really, you know, like, I'm not like, I don't really look too deep into lyrics, and I'm not really like a lyrics guy. I'm more about like the melody and all that stuff and vocal pattern and everything. But if you listen to his songs, and I just took it for granted that he'd like, oh, Tom Petty, he'll always be that, you know, like he just, like he'd always be. And, you know, for such a great artist, and I mean, you know, sometimes, you know, it's you have to something to really appreciate what you had. And I really wish I got to see him in concert, because you know, that would have been, you know, that would have been amazing.
He came to New York, Buffalo, and Darien Lake all the time. I got to see him many times.
And if any Tom Petty fan,
like, I took it for granted too. I mean, he came so much that I would just like be walking around the fringes of Darien Lake and you can just see from like 200 feet away, you know, and hear him. It's like, I don't need to be there. I don't need to buy tickets. I can see him right there and hear him, and sounds great. And he was a great artist. I'll look into the conspiracies and look into see if he was a pedophile and whatnot. It's like why don't we do this while they're alive, folks? Like, aren't we supposed to like not wait till they're dead and then do this while they're alive and incarcerate them? Like, we don't, like, God, this world is so backwards.
Well, for Petty fans out there that never heard, his original band was called Mudcrutch, and in the early 2000s, I think, he put out he got the old guys back together, and they did a record, and he played more like the original style of what the band, you know, kind of like Southern rock kind of country thing, and it's a really good record, so you can if you never heard it,
cool.
Get out.
I've never heard of that. It's badass.
Because what happened with that was, just keep on Tom Petty for one second, is they brought out to L.A. The band went out to L.A. and the record label said, want you, none of these guys. We don't want any of these guys. We just want you. And Tom Petty said, okay. And I was like, what a dickhead. But you know what? At the end of the day, you got to do what's best. You know, I mean, so if he just stuck with his old, with those guys, like, yeah, it's kind of a dick move, but – you know, what's he supposed to do? You know, go back and, you know, struggle as a musician, or, you know, go on, move on, and, you know, do his thing. And you know, I always thought, like, cause I was kind of young and in a band, and I was like, oh, well, if somebody did that to me, I'd hate him forever. But, you know, you can't, judge people like that, you know? Like, I got a friend who went off and became a rock star and kind of blew us all off, but that's what he had to do. And now later on, he's kind of getting in touch with the old fellas. He gave us a shout out at a show the other night. So that was pretty cool. But, you know, you just, again, the whole judgment thing, you know. And that's kind of like a selfish thing of me to say, like, well, my friend, you know, the guy I'm in the band with, they want him, but they don't want me. That's selfish of me to say, you better not do that, or I'm mad at you for doing that. That's just, you know, I think that's a selfish thing.
Sure, keep talking about anything, and I'm going to go refill this drink. I'll be back in a minute. And,
right on.
And then when I get back, I'll share the screen and show you the incredible story of how I met my first cousin, my dad's brother. And I haven't talked to him ever. Like, I didn't even know he existed. I thought that he only had like three children. I didn't know there was a fourth. So this is a great story. And yeah, I'll be back in a minute. Just talk about whatever the fuck you want, man.
Right on. Okay, so we're gonna talk about the Yankees real quick. They moved on they're in the division round tonight, and I was watching a movie today that I never saw that I always wanted to see. It's called Bang the Drum Slowly. It's got Robert De Niro and Michael Moriarty are the stars, and it's about a pitcher. Michael Moriarty is the pitcher, and Robert De Niro is the catcher on the New York Yankees. And Robert De Niro is like a, you know, kind of a dim-witted, but a really good ball, you know, really good ball player. And it turns out he has Hodgkin's disease, but the pitcher stuck behind him and stuck with him, cause they wanted to just dump him and send him down to the minor leagues and trade him. But the pitcher stuck with, the catcher, and, you know, he kind of protected him. You know, so they're going through the season and doing really good. And it turns out that the Yankees are going to the World Series, but he has to go to Minnesota to get treatment for his Hodgkin's disease. And, you know, so the one of the last scenes, they showed De Niro saying, look, I'll be back next season, all healthy. And he goes, send me a card from the World Series, a scorecard. And then, you know, De Niro gets on the plane, and then the next scene is they're visiting his grave. And,
listen, go ahead, man.
And it was just, you know, it was, I just, you know, I love baseball movies, and it just I'm sure they show it because, you know, it's playoff season, but it's a really good movie if you like baseball movies, and you know, it's not like it's really well done. It's just a
what movie is this?
It's called Bang the Drum Slowly.
It's okay, I heard of that one.
Yeah, it's like a classic. But
my roommate Sean, you two are like two peas in a pod fucking with the Yankees. So let me get back to this fucking epic story here. Now I'm gonna share my screen here. There's an echo there. Is the YouTube on or something?
No, I don't have anything on in the back.
It's gone there, Mark. So let's see here. I'm gonna share my screen. Oh, here we go. And now, okay. Could you see it?
Yeah, I got your screen.
All right. It's good to get high in your own little town. It's good to have friends. Yeah, there's certain things that save you.
Oh, yeah.
Cool. It's Zen, and it's Bob.
Bob.
No, actually, I mean, when I was studying Alan Watts, English philosopher, Robert Anton Wilson, American author and conspiracy hunter, and a guerrilla ontologist, which is somebody who like purposely triggers people and mind shocks them every second. like gonzo journalists, like you know, Hunter S. Thompson and Terrence McKenna, and these are like psychonauts, like people who are traveling in different dimensions and who come back with jewels and treasures for and share it with us all. And so I.
Oh shit. The link just shut down for no reason. What are you eating, eggs? Mm-hmm. Smells good.
Yo, can you hear me?
Yeah, I got you, man. Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, something happened. It's fucking boom.
That was weird. That's interesting because I was just talking really deep into things for a second there, fucking damn it! All right, let's get back on track here. Hold on, I got Antonio calling me, bro. I'm gonna send him. Do you mind if I bring Antonio onto this, or?
Oh, do what you gotta do, brother. The more, the merrier.
I'll just throw a link towards him, see if he wants to join. He likes this conversation, and he just told me, I'll be there. You know I've dropped, right? Or you know you've dropped, right? All right, well, there we go. I just want to hear his voice. Yeah. I can't. That was the worst impression I've ever done. All right, hold on. My computer's still loading and going slow.
Yeah, I just got a new one. The cord wrapped around my foot, and I went, you know, go get a beer or something, and it ripped, and it just broke the fucking the port in the computer. That's why I was offline for a while, because I couldn't get back on Facebook because I couldn't remember my password, and then I was trying to get back on and all that. Plus, I was going through that time too, so everybody's like, "Oh my God, what happened?" And I'm like, "No."
All right, so here goes. Sorry about that, everyone. Fuck, lost some viewers. That's all right.
Yeah, well, they'll come back.
Oh, what's up, Antonio?
Oh, real quick, Dan. Just before I forget to tell you, Immortal Technique is coming on. Drunk News.
Oh, I know. Yes. Yeah, Josh, I saw that. Josh told me I'm excited for him. That's funny because I was sending Immortal Technique. There's a little screen going on. I've got to mute you. Goddamn, what? There's a muting you all. All right, so I was sending Immortal Technique. Messages on his Instagram and on his Twitter when we were chilling with Diabolic, and then I was answering his questions because Immortal Technique had some questions about the flat Earth, and then all these stupid globehead trolls were flooding his feed, so I just do what I always do and I just stick my foot in their ass one by one, and then I messaged Immortal Technique this morning, and then Josh, yeah, that was pretty cool. So I'm pretty pumped for him. That's going to be awesome. I wonder what they're going to talk about. It's going to be badass. But yeah, guys, just unmute yourselves when you want to talk, because there's annoying feedback, and you know I can't stand that shit.
Yeah, that's crazy. But my buddies met him after a show. He did a show at this ski lodge in New Jersey where they have – it's funny because it's Christian owned, and we played there one time. And they're like, you can't say this. You can't say that. You can't say this. You can't say that. They gave us like all the – it's like, why'd you book us, man? You know we're fucking crazy. So my buddies met him there, and, you know, they hung – they said, cool guy. They hung out with them. They said, you know, because they turned me on to him saying that, you know, he like what he talks about in his lyrics and everything, and I've seen him interviewed, and I'm like, man, this guy's really deep, you know. Like I thought, you know, that like hip hop was just, you know, like skinny jeans and fucking dyed hair now. I thought like, you know, it was just like these goofy guys, but you know, I never heard of Diabolik before. Diabolik. I would have loved to talk to him a little hip hop because he was like, oh, I'm not really into KRS-One. I'm like, but he's the-
Yeah, there's a disc. KRS-One has beef with Immortal Technique and his boys. And he called them like a Mickey Mouse Club, and I'm like, what? I'm like, apparently you don't listen to Immortal Technique. Are you fucking stupid? So I don't know. That's what I would ask him. I would ask, what's with the deal with the beef with fucking KRS-One here? Why did he call you Mickey Mouse Club? How do you feel about? Nah, I don't want to incite fucking anything. I wouldn't. I don't know. Sometimes I do, but that seems a little bit personal. But what are you doing, Antonio? Can you hear us? Is everything going all right? You there? You making coffee? I go coffee now. All right. Well, he'll come in. So we talked about the Dark Night of the Soul, Chapel Perilous, Crossing the River of Tears. We talked about some Tom Petty, some Yanks in and out. Yeah, I want to tell you about the J.R. Bob Dobbs story. So let me get into this. Now, I hope if I share my screen, it won't kick us off again. So I'm going to try it again, and if it does it again, then I'm not going to be fucking sharing my screen. But that's weird because it should let me share my screen. It's never done that before. So here goes. And please, yeah, thank you for coming back. We'll see what happens. It already says not responding. All right, I'm kind of nervous. Here it goes. So, you still there, Jokerfish?
I'm still here.
Okay. So, my screen's good and nothing's dropped out and...
Yeah.
Okay. Well, here it goes.
Here we go.
So church... How about this? Sorry for fucking. I should have had this prepared.
Oh, good.
Fucking. Hurry the fuck up. I'm sorry, everyone. I'm going to find this in freaking 1 minute.
Please stand by. 24 past the hour.
Or a really good radio host, I'd be able to fill in that dead air time with... some solid thoughts in between while I'm trying to segue into the next segment here, but it's taking me longer than I expected.
That's a joke me and the crew have. Like, if it gets quiet for a second, someone will just go, it's 24 hour.
All right. Oh my gosh. Why is this taking... Yeah, I guess it was over 13 hours ago. All right, hold on, I'm almost there. Okay, now check this out. Now first...
Antonio's mic's not working.
Yo, Antonio, we can't hear you, man.
He said his mic's not working.
Oh, that's fucked up. Oh, okay. All right, well, I'm just going to put you on mute since your mic's not working. Fuck it. All right, but let's see here. So I'm going to share my screen. So now this is the eerie part. This is the really, really, really mysterious and synchronistic coincidence part. Now, can you see this?
Yeah.
So now this is a closed group here. This is the Church of the Subgenius. I'm an official member, and so I shared this video, Chapel Perilous, along the way to the mystery. I want to see if you can hear it. Let me know if you can hear it, Jokerfish. Oh, actually, right, yeah, I got an idea. Not only I made a transcript for it. Well, I didn't. Somebody else did, and I copied it. So check this out. So now tell me how relevant and synchronistic this is to the conversation we're having right now. Now look at this shit. Now this says Chapel Perilous, along the way to the mystery. And so now, I mean, I'd rather you watch this with. Let me know if you can hear it first. Let me know if you can hear it.
All right.
Uh-huh.
Robert Anton Wilson.
Yeah.
Okay, now I'll turn it up just a little bit, and I have the words transcribed, so you'll be able to see it. Hold on. Okay, so now check this out. And now you see the words right here?
Yeah.
Okay, here goes.
Robert Anton Wilson, who coined the term Chapel Perilous. This is when something happens in your life and it all begins to fit together and make sense.
Too much sense.
Because it's coming from the exterior, and it seems to either mean that you're losing your mind or you are somehow the central focus of the universal conspiracy leading you towards some unimaginable breakthrough.
Getting trippy, huh?
Along the way to the mystery lie the realms of
loving everybody, moving fields of geometric color, past lives, you name it.
But these are just milestones on the way. You finally get to the thing. The way you will know that you've arrived is that you will be struck dumb with wonder.
This is impossible.
This is impossible. This is what impossible was invented to talk about. This cannot be. Then we're in the ballpark. Now then we're in the presence of the true coincidentia of the coin. There are all kinds of drugs and techniques, hot water and tongue and this man, violent therapy, that moves you all over the map. Makes me all
kinds of
things. I don't think that's what we're talking about. I think we're talking about something profoundly mute yourself, Joker. It is very hard to get this thing out in the mainstream because literally words fail. It is a transcendistic object accessible to us here and now. And it's a complete puzzle to me why there is so little talk. About it, we live in a society completely obsessed with sensation. You know, people shoot cocaine, jump out of airplanes, go on tiny rafts across the Pacific, cross an arc pole on a roller skate, whatever. But in the name of adventure.
My God, if you want adventure, there's adventure out there. Adventure that will sink you to your knees with tears of joy streaming down your face.
It isn't far away. It isn't for people you've never heard of, or universities who don't need a lot of fun for it. It's never going to be a profession. All of this stuff. Everybody talks about the mystery within and how it's all right here.
But I don't think people realize how literal this stuff is. It's so interesting because I just my neighbor came over the other day and I was talking to him about DMT, and he's like totally obsessed with it now. And he's like, I can't get it out of my mind. I have to find this. And I told him that everything I was telling him, I'm like, yeah, these things are like literally jumping on us right now. And I'm like, I mean that literally. They're like we're in a different dimension right now, but we just can't see it. And when I heard that, you know, everybody talks about the mystery within and how it's all right here. It's like, but I don't think people realize how literal all this stuff is. And so now you see the what we just heard and talked about, right? And so I shared it. I'm going to share that in my Church of the Subgenius group. And so I shared it, and it says Terry McKenna, his name's Terrence McKenna, but his friends call him Terry, so I call him Terry. Terry McKenna talking about what Robert Anton Wilson called the Dark Night of the Soul, or Chapel Perilous, or what Jim Carrey calls Crossing the River of Tears. You don't have to do it that way, and I wouldn't suggest it to anyone unless you enjoy traumatic experiences. And so I shared it, and look at the first comment. Cuz? And I go, what the fuck? And obviously he laughs. I didn't believe it. I was like, I just thought that his last name was Falkenbach, and he was just fucking with me because he's a subgenius. And so I'm like, are you Native American and German? Or Mexican Spanish? He's like, Native American and German? Maybe we are fucking cousins. Maybe we fucking are cousins. Weird sync because of Church of the Seven. It gets weirder. You better have watched the video, I told him. I am now. He said, oh shit, we are cousins. And this is the fucked up part. His dad's name is Bob. He's my dad's brother. It's Uncle Bob. That's my Uncle Bob. And the leader, the prophet of the Church of the Subgenius is J.R. Bob Dobbs. And the Church of the Subgenius is what made me find my first cousin, reunited with him. And not only that, his dad's name is Bob. We really are cousins. We're both subgenius. And this video that I posted, I was the 23rd view on that video, and that's one of Bob's favorite numbers and Robert Anton Wilson's favorite number. And that shit's totally, totally trippy. Like, I ended up talking with him for fucking like an hour and learning family secrets, like I said, and, you know, weeping tears of joy with some of the things that he told me about my brother. And just... It was, I mean, how fucking crazy is that? Praise Bob. Praise Bob.
Well, yeah, like that's just one of those, it's just amazing how, you know, you two just out of nowhere. You're like, wait a minute. You know, like, in, you know, that's like a fucking, you know, you couldn't write that, you know? Like how,
shit. Sorry, man.
Just out of nowhere. Like, wait
a minute. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm just going to shrink this down. All right, so I refreshed this. Are we still live here?
Yeah, it says live. On.
I stopped sharing, right?
Yeah, you're good.
All right. So, Antonio, sorry that your mic's fucked up. Try to get that fixed. Let's see here. So now I've got to – okay, cool. So now I shared the fucking – we got through the Dark Night of the Soul. We told the J.R. Bob Dobbs story. Now I don't really want to get into the Vegas stuff so much, but we will. Let's see here. So, yeah. I mean, in my opinion – hey, do you remember that red paperclip guy who traded a paperclip in for a fucking, like – crowbar, and then like took the crowbar and traded in for a fucking like a fucking oven, and then traded the oven for like a fucking couch or something, and then traded the couch for a fucking He just kept trading and getting more value. And then he ended up getting a fucking house from a box of a red paper clip. Kyle McDonald, yeah, he's my he's a flat earther now. Have you ever heard of that guy?
No.
Okay, well, you can look him up. He's had TED Talks. He's gone to different countries and had foreign TED Talks and commercials and millions of views on YouTube. And he came over two nights ago, and it was his birthday. And we had some drinks, and we talked about the Vegas thing mostly. And Sean was there listening. And Sean was like, that's so fucking funny that that dude's coming over. He's like, just going to chill and talk with him. I'm like, yeah, dude, we're fucking buddies and friends. And, you know, he's a flat earther now, and we got to stick together. And I was telling him, I'm like, he was like, he's good with words. And he's like, well, you know, here's the thing about this. There's like 60 people that died and like 600, like over like fucking like 500 people that were injured. And you're on the 32nd floor and maybe other floors, and you're just shooting. And they say there's one shooter and he's a lone wolf. And they call him a lone wolf if he's white and a terrorist if he's brown.
Right.
Or mentally ill if he's white, and a terrorist if he's black or brown. And so, like, white people are just the lone wolves or mentally ill. They're not terrorists. And so it's so funny how the news always uses those particular words. But, there's always a friend of a friend. I know my uncle's sister's friend's brother's friend was at there, so, like, you know, show some respect. And, you know, he was injured and he's in the hospital. And, oh, can I have a pit? Can I have evidence of that? I can't give you any evidence. Oh, that's all I want is some evidence of 10,000 phones that were around and no live feed from the police body cameras, no live video footage from the hotel of a guy coming back and, oh, well, it's because he was a long-standing member of there, and so he got to go in. Shut. He's a fucking ninja. He's an old man ninja who's got the strength of a titan. And if you look at the windows that were busted out, they're all photoshopped. They're fucking they're so lazy now that they fucking just they can't even make the windows broken out in different patterns. All the windows they're like two. They just copy and paste the same thing with that NASA does with the clouds. They're so lazy to create actual realistic clouds that they copy and paste, and that's how we find them out. We can bust them because we're good with Photoshop and breaking down CGI composite images that aren't real. And I've talked to so many people. I've had many people in Las Vegas. I've been talking to Matt Powerland and his wife Katie, and they're in Las Vegas while it happened. And I woke them up and let them know what the hell is going on there. And are they playing? There's did you see the picture of the guy giving the middle finger? And
no, I heard about it. I saw one where a guy's standing there. I think you shared it. He's going, pussy, come on, pussy. You know, he's holding his arms out. And you hear a guy go, it's fake. It's coming through the sound system. I saw that video.
Yeah, so I mean, honestly, I don't even want to go to my Facebook page and read off the things that I said as soon as I heard the reports, because I mean, it's not some competition to say I'm the first one who was calling out fucking false flag bullshit psyop from the beginning. And but I said this is totally fucking, this is totally rigged. This has been staged, and this is a drill that these crisis actors have been working on for weeks now. And I said, P.S. this type of event is always followed by a celebrity death. And then the very next within fucking 12 hours,
Tom Petty.
And I fucking called it. And I've done this over and over again. That's because I can see the patterns. I know what they do, and all their numbers are linked up. It's on the 33rd floor if you count the lobby. So the 32nd floor, which is the second level, highest level of Freemasonry, supposedly. And then he sacrifices himself and reaches the 33rd. Tom Petty died when he's 66, which is double 33. The supposed killer had 23 guns. 23, again, see how these numbers keep coming up? And it's like, well, you're looking into this too much, Dan. Well, guess what? The woman had a newscaster had a microphone with 33 on the side of it. Is that a coincidence too? Is there? Remember how it said the assailant was killing people for 9 to 11 minutes. 9 to 11 minutes? Never in a million years would you say something like that. You're saying that on purpose.
Yeah, those numbers are
it's fucking codes. And all these little groups and clubs of psychopaths, that's how they let each other know what group is doing it. Oh, it's the Scottish Rite. Oh, it's fucking these guys. It's fucking they're not many. There's just a few of them. It's all right, you know. They do their thing. They're trying to fill everyone with fear and get everyone confused and have everyone fighting amongst themselves. Here's the thing. Instead of fighting amongst ourselves and pointing fingers at amongst ourselves and having your – okay, are we
– Yeah, we're still going.
Okay. Like your buddy Jason, now I have a mental illness because I don't believe that fucking I don't believe the news, and I don't fucking – I asked the guy who told me. I'm sure you've watched the live leak footage of the person going around with a camera and, hey, are you okay? And just going around to these people who are not talking and not responding and asking them if they're okay, and then checking their pulse. It's like, what? Have you ever been around real blood and real like crazy? Like I've been inside a Los Angeles riot. Like when the Los Angeles Lakers won the championship,
people went crazy
in 2007. They're fucking. My roommate got arrested. We were flipping over fucking police cars in the fucking streets and throwing Molotov cocktails out the window. Like I've been inside of real riots with LAPD with bulletproof 100% stormtroopers with German shepherds and shotguns around me, like I multiple times.
Full body armor, all that shit. Like yeah. You know. With it.
Somebody asked, "Do people actually die in false flags?" Well, some people do. When you have fucking a whole building collapse on itself, there's gonna unless that entire area was surrounded or was evacuated, there's gonna be fucking consequences. So that's how they mix. Lies with the truth, and that's how they fuck with. That's how they discredit the truthers who are trying to expose these criminals for their. It's like yeah, this is wrong. If anyone actually did die, they would want people to investigate the truth and find out what's really going on behind the fucking scenes. That's the whole point of journalism and being an investigator. You're supposed to fucking incarcerate and get rid of these fucking maniacs and do, you know, it's like, why you don't attack the guy exposing the lies. You try to fucking figure, you know what I mean, man?
Well, yeah, that's like the old whistleblower syndrome. Like, you know, if somebody comes out and says, well, this is what's going on. Well, that person gets, you know, ostracized or, you know, let's take Jose Canseco. Broke the whole thing on the baseball steroids thing. They just, you know.
He's the fall guy.
What's that?
He was the fall guy.
Yeah, exactly. And they'll take like, you know, like there was somebody, some woman in the military who you know, she was like a whistleblower on something. She got locked up in fucking, you know, in military jail. Edward Snowden is fucking not allowed in the fucking country. He's like hiding out in Russia because the whistleblower. And if he comes here, they're going to fucking lock his ass up for the rest of his life. You know, it's just funny how the people that are out there that speak the truth and expose something get discredited. I mean, people look at Jose Canseco as a fucking, you know, I just know baseball better than
like Sammy Sosa, Mark McGwire, they were all thrown under the bus.
Yeah, fucking Roger Clemens, fucking A-Rod, like all these guys. You know, but Sammy Sosa was the one that came out and wrote the book, and they just, you know, it just made him look like a fool. Mm-hmm. But did he tell the truth? Yes, he did.
And then he did the Michael Jackson transition, didn't he, after that?
What do you mean?
Didn't he turn white with that disease? Didn't he get that disease?
Oh, no, yeah, that's Sammy Sosa. Yeah, Sammy Sosa. They said because he wanted to be like an actor or something, and
that shit was weird. That was some MK Ultra fucking glitches.
Yeah, like if you look at Sammy Sosa when he was a ball player and you look at him now, you'll be like, that's the same guy.
Yeah. All right. Well, I mean, that was good. I don't want to dwell on that shit. I just wanted to kind of fuck. I mean, you want to get your thoughts about that shit?
You know, I really don't have any. I just don't know what to believe anymore. I don't pay attention to the news. I hear things. I read things a little bit. But, you know, in this day and age, I don't know fucking what to trust. I don't, you know. I if I'm around and somebody's got like MSNBC or one of them news stations on, it's just for fucking ratings, you know. It's the Howard Stern show. It's like the Rush Limbaugh show. Fucking, there's no difference between Rachel Maddow and fucking Howard Stern. There's no difference between fucking Morning Joe and Rush Limbaugh. They're all out for ratings, man.
All right. So how's everybody doing out there in the chat world? It's good to be king.
That song's running through my head, man. I was just singing that in my head.
You were? Isn't that song incredible? That's how Felix.
I mean, I think everybody one day, just at least one day in their life, needs to feel like they're, you know, I don't know. Like, I remember one time we had fucking Giants tickets and we got to sit in the luxury box. And it was just like, I felt like a king. You know, it was just like, I felt special for that couple hours. I think everybody needs that at least once in their life.
Yo, what's up, John Rich?
What's that? John Rich is there?
Yeah.
What's up, Johnny boy?
What's up, host Hoosier Flatty? JR out there, Felix.
Hey, Felix.
Let's see here. That's enough of those. Okay, well, Moonflower, you can stop asking fucking annoying, negative, draining questions, please. I know you like to drain everyone. Let's see. Hey, Rock Vibrations.
That's a cool name.
So, let's see here. We've talked about We told the Dark Night of the Soul, the Bob Dobbs story, the current news events. We covered fucking Tom Petty, the Vegas thing. And how about, and let's see here. Okay, I'll show you some. Okay, well, what do you remember about Orson Welles? Tell me everything you know and remember about Orson Welles.
First of all, I'm a huge Orson Welles fan. He was a brilliant fucking guy. He started out doing plays and directing plays and all that. But the thing that sticks out most to me was the War of the Worlds broadcast in the late 30s or early 40s, where people were in a panic. My mother told me this story of my grandparents were probably married, like just recently married, and they're, you know, radio was the big form of entertainment. And Orson Welles was reading War of the Worlds as if he was a reporter on scene. And it's funny, like the landing, like they said that they were invading New Jersey because it was near Princeton and somewhere else. And my grandmother started to get scared, which a lot of the people that were listening to thought this was real. It just so happened that my grandfather had read the War of the Worlds book. And he's like, no, this is just, you know, it's a story. But he did a broadcast and people went crazy. Police called the police, fucking got all these calls.
Evacuating?
I don't think they, I just think they were like, you know.
Oh, some people evacuated, dude.
Said, hey, there's aliens. They're going to tell you to go fuck yourself, you know?
No, there was a national pandemic.
Yeah, like people went like nuts. And
there's a reason they don't teach about that and shit in school. Some no name fucking, like, dude, that's wild. He's the original Andy Kaufman.
That was brilliant. I heard that story. My mother told me that when I was a kid. I always thought that was like the greatest thing in the world, you know, with like this guy just tricked the whole fucking country. People were losing their fucking shit. They're like, oh. And he's sitting there laughing, you know, but he's reading it like it's a real news report. And now that's brilliant, man. How you, like, he just totally, totally fucked with the whole country. And
total revolutionary.
Yeah, and you know, because I, and you know, back then, like, I guess like UFOs were just kind of getting into the consciousness of the public. Aliens were just kind of getting into the consciousness of the public, because I don't really remember, you know, too much stuff about, like, I just remember like hearing that, and you know, like that was really like a big fucking deal. And I just said, that is just so amazing. He could do, like, he could just pull that off.
Man. The reason I got into Orson Welles is because of Robert Anton Wilson, actually. Robert Anton Wilson's biggest influence and inspiration in his life was Orson Welles. I'm not sure if they fucking met. I'm going to have to read stories on that, check that out. But because Robert Anton Wilson always has amazing stories when he meets certain people. Like, you know, the sci-fi conspiracy author Philip K. Dick?
I've never heard of him.
Man. Actually, he wrote Minority Report.
Okay.
What else? Fuck. So I can't believe I can't remember. Did he write now? Was it Vanilla Sky? No, I don't think so. I'm just fucking tripping now. What else? I don't know. He's made hundreds of books. He's written hundreds of books, and they're all the government the government steals these people's ideas. So like these people, this is what my personal theory is, that why these people don't get famous. Oh, see, Antonio knows. Scanner Darkly.
Okay.
Total Recall, Blade Runner.
Oh, I love that.
These are all Philip K. Dick novels.
Okay, so I know his work. I know his work.
So what they do? They don't allow these people to become like ultra famous. Just the fringe. They're on the outside, and then they die in obscurity and poor and infamous. And then the government comes in, and then they steal all of their work, all of the hard work that they did their entire lives. And they worked for nothing, not for nothing. But then the government comes in and then makes a movie out of their story, and they don't give the person any credit at all. They don't mention him at all. They're like, this is my idea. And give us money, and look, it's like, wow, dude, that's so disrespectful. And I noticed they did that with Robert Anton Wilson's book, The Illuminatus Trilogy. The movie, The Number 23, that's exactly, Jim Carrey, by the way, starred in it, so it's all coming back around. And and the original movie, 23, was a Russian movie, and it was made in like 1998 or 1999. And it's all in Russian, and I watched half of it so far, and it's good. I got to watch the second half. And obviously, I watched The Number 23 with Jim Carrey, which is an underrated movie. And any Jim Carrey's movies that are dramas, like Truman Show, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, and Number 23, and he's an underrated dramatic actor. Truman Show is one of my favorite stories movies.
You know, I'm a big fan of Jackie Gleason, and one time Jackie Gleason said, comedians can become great actors. You never see an actor become a great comedian.
Exactly.
You know, and it's true, because, look at John Belushi. I mean, he was an amazing comedic actor, but he also played, the straight role, and even people, like some people would say, like, he was more of a dramatic actor than a comedic actor. But, just knowing Jim Belushi from, like, Animal House and fucking Blues Brothers or Saturday Night Live and all that stuff, you'd think that, oh, he's just this comedy guy. But he did, before he died, he did, like, one or two, like leading man kind of serious roles. And they, people really give him a lot of credit for that.
I only know Jim Belushi because, obviously the Blues Brothers and –
Jim's the brother.
You're talking about John Belushi?
Yeah, John Belushi.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't know too much about.
Well, he's Blues Brothers. That's Animal House and Blues Brothers.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's what I was just talking about.
Yeah, that's
Isn't he like Chris Farley's biggest influence?
You know what? I don't know. I mean, probably, because,
that kind of... Look at the way they acted. They're like fucking... Chris Farley's like a reincarnation of the motherfucker.
You know, Chris Farley was just, great, man. But I don't think he ever got to who he could have been. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Same with Andy Kaufman. Now, here's the thing about Andy Kaufman. I just found... An Orson Welles interviewing Andy Kaufman.
Oh,
and
I think you put that up.
I found it last night, I uploaded it on my channel, and I watched it like fucking five times. It's like 6 minutes long. But I've watched like all of Andy Kaufman's stuff, and I've only watched a few of Orson Welles' films. My favorite being called F is for Fake, and the whole film is about plagiarism and how artists plagiarize from one another, and they fuck with reality, and they skew the lines, and every single scene in the movie F is for Fake is. It's not real. Like, it's very hard to explain. It's one of the trippiest movies that I've ever watched. Orson Welles is I can't wait to go down the Orson Welles rabbit hole. Like, I've only dipped my foot in the water, so it's going to be quite a swim. And I have like this new comedian that I found. Dude, I went so far down the rabbit hole last night that I found the man that Lodka is based off of. Like, I found him personally, and I know who he is.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, I can email him like and talk about it and that's how far down the rabbit hole I go. Like, I literally found the guy who Andy Kaufman. It's not just one guy. It was the main guy was his best friend or his roommate in college, which was some foreign Iranian dude. And so Andy Kaufman guy kind of talked like that, and it was a combination of these two other dudes, like Iraqi, Iranian, and some other dude. And he's like, I just blended all their voices together, and that was the first character that I made, which is Latka, and that was the first character he ever went on stage with and created. Sorry, I take that back. Elvis Presley impersonations was his first character.
Oh, yeah, when he would do his Elvis and his leg, which he would sneer, yep. And he would...
Elvis was the first first character he did, and then it was Latka, and then it was Tony Clifton.
Oh man, that was the biggest rib, the biggest work, the biggest, because he had in his contract on Taxi that Tony Clifton would, and he just came in character with hookers, smoking a cigar, and just like insulting him, just being filthy, and Bob's. You know, and you never, because Bob Zmuda would do it sometimes, you know, so you never knew. Because, like, was that you I was talking to about when Bob Zmuda, it was like a press conference, and Bob Zmuda came out to Tony Cliff, and he's like, hey, and he just comes in, like, just takes over the fuck. He just walks in and starts yelling.
Yeah, actually, was that Jim Carrey? Did he interrupt Jim Carrey's interview for, like, promoting Man on the Moon?
Yeah, I think it was a Man on the Moon promotion, and yeah, he just came in, and I'm sure those had it worked out, but
Jim Carrey was totally involved in it, obviously.
Well,
Jim Carrey was totally in the part of Andy Kaufman. He said that he wasn't Jim Carrey. That's just what he's going through right now. He said he wasn't like that. Totally fucked him up, his whole psyche. He said that becoming Andy Kaufman. He literally channeled, and he said, "I was taken over by Andy," and he was Andy for a year. And he was doing other movie interviews or auditions in the character of Andy Kaufman. He never gave it up.
He never broke. He never broke the. He just stayed.
And Bob Zmuda obviously helped him. And Bob Zmuda dressed up as Tony Clifton and went to the Playboy Mansion, and. One of the security guards told Hugh that it was Jim Carrey underneath the costume, underneath it. He's like, oh, it's Jim Carrey. Okay. He's like, so Hugh Hefner's playing along with the part. And next thing you know, like Jim Carrey shows up and Hugh Hefner's like, what the fuck? And all the bodyguards surround the Tony Clifton, and they kick him out. And Jim Carrey's like, be easy on him, guys. Be easy on him. And this dude, he did the same thing with Bob Zmuda. Andy Kaufman did the same thing with Bob Zmuda. And they would so these hookers and Playboy playmates would think that they're fucking Andy Kaufman in the Bob Zmuda or in the Tony Clifton outfit. But in reality, it would be Bob Zmuda banging this dirty, dirty little man up, banging, like, he's a foot shorter than Jim Carrey and Andy Kaufman. So it's like, how does he play that character? How can he be so good at that character to be a foot shorter? What a genius!
Yeah. And,
but dude, there's so many stories I could tell about that. Actually, go ahead and fucking take over for a minute. I'm gonna refill my drink.
Okay. There's a movie, it's called, it's based off of a movie called My Dinner with Andre, which was, it was like a dramatic movie or something. I don't know. I never saw it. It's just a classic. Andy Kaufman did My Breakfast with Blassie, Freddie Blassie, who was a wrestler and then like a wrestling manager. If anybody's out there from like the 80s, you know, he was the Iron Sheik's manager, and it was Classy Freddie Blassie. And those two were really good friends, Andy Kaufman and Classy Freddie Blassie. So what he did was, Freddie Blassie was like a germaphobe, and so was Andy Kaufman. But he had Bob Zmuda, and they're sitting there eating breakfast, and Bob Zmuda comes up, and he's like, oh, you know, like he's a fan, and like pukes on the table. and Freddie Blassie just freaks out, you know, just goes nuts. And, you know, it was, it's, if you know, if you like Andy Kaufman, check out my Breakfast with Blassie, cause it is fucking great. And I think they might've touched on that in, Man on the Moon, the movie Man on the Moon, how his relationship with, classy Freddie Blassie. Cause remember he did that with Jerry King Lawler. Yeah. And, you know, nobody, like, he came up and, you know, people still, and I remember, like, people.
Yeah, but he was tricking Jerry Lawler too.
Yeah. People would ask Jerry Lawler and he would never say anything. And finally, he was like, you know, I guess Jerry finally figured it out that he was fucking with them. And he's like, yeah. Because when he gave him a pile driver on the David Letterman show with a neck brace, and he would, like, challenge women to wrestle him, and he's, like, the intergender champion, and the whole wrestling thing was just so funny. And a lot of people, you know, because he would go in L.A., they would have at the Sportatorium the wrestling matches, and he would always, you know, try to get back and meet the wrestlers, and they were like, get the fuck away from me. I remember Roddy Piper in his book was telling a story. He's like, yeah, some fucking, you know, weirdo comedian kept trying to fuck – you know, meet me and wanted to do, and I just said, I told him to fuck off. And then finally he hooked up with Jerry Lawler down in Memphis, and it took off from there. And, you know, there was the whole thing where Jerry Lawler, like, smacked Jerry Lawler.
On Letterman?
Yeah.
Like, okay, coughing first, fucking, he threw water in his face and then fucking slapped him.
Yeah, he threw water in his face, then he stands up and he smacks him. And then that's when the pile driver, and he's wearing the, I'm going to sue you. But he laid there on the ground. He just laid there on the set and just wouldn't move, you know. Because
Jerry, oh, yeah, I'm going to sue you. He knows Tom Cruise. He's like, I'm going to sue you. Oh, I'm so going to sue you.
It was, you. I mean, you know, I know a lot of people compare Jim Carrey to Andy Kaufman, but I think Norm Macdonald has a lot of Andy Kaufman in him too. Because I think Andy Kaufman, his comedy was amusing himself. I think most of what Andy did was to amuse himself rather than, you know, make money or to be like a star. He just, you know, if you ever see the thing, like they did on Saturday Night Live with the Mighty Mouse song, where he's standing there, he puts the record on, and then he goes, here I come to save the day. That means that Mighty Mouse is on the way. And then he just stands there and turns the record off. I mean, and people were like, what the fuck? You know, but
he wasn't really liked. And I mean, he would go on stage and eat a bowl of ice cream for 5 minutes and walk away.
He would read a book. He would just take a book and start reading, and people would be like screaming, do laka. He'd be reading the book. And there was another thing where he goes, okay, we're all going out for milk and cookies. And people were like, ah, ha, ha, that's fun. There was buses outside, and people got, like, the people that went to the show got on the buses, and he really took them for milk and cookies. You know?
Yeah. He did it more than once, too. He did it a lot. It was a Now, here's the most interesting part. Did you know that Tony Clifton was a real comedian?
Yes.
And Tony Clifton was an all-American comic, just a hack. And, you know, just worked his whole entire life. Like, every day, 9 to 5, doing the opposite of what I would like to do. I'm taking the opposite path. I'm trying to stay away from the stage as much as possible. I've gone on stage, and I've done stand-up comedy over a dozen times, well over a dozen times, fucking probably close to fucking almost 50 times at this point. But that's honestly nothing. That's true. Like, a regular working comedian who's 20 years old nowadays goes on stage 5 to 10 times a week. I'm not even fucking exaggerating. These people are insane. I have no interest in that. I don't want to do that.
Well, what they do is they'll just go and they'll say, okay, you got 5 minutes. And they'll go up and they'll do 5 minutes at this place. Then they'll go down to the open mic night. Then they'll go down to Caroline's. Then they'll go down to, you know.
Get all the spots, exactly.
You know, I like that guy, Hannibal Buress. And he would host an amateur night. In a club, and just like a bar in Brooklyn. I don't know if he still does it, But like, I thought that, you know, like, so he would kind of host it. But what was cool is like, if you were interested and like, and you could go and talk to him and ask him questions. And I always thought that that was really cool, because it was a way for, first of all, that was a way for him to make money, you know, because Hannibal Buress, I don't think he's that popular.
Pretty popular, man. He's the guy who exposed Bill Cosby.
Oh yeah, that's right. Ever since that, he goes, because like he was, when Bill Cosby said, "Oh, these people with their, you're wearing a," he goes, "Shut up, Bill Cosby, you're a rapist."
Dude, it was so amazing. Actually,
I love
this was the joke. He goes, what was it? He goes, he's like, he was talking about how he's not popular, like he's not a famous guy, and he goes, if you type in Hannibal Buress, you'll get like 100 or 1,000 hits on Google. He's like, if you type in Bill Cosby rapist, you'll get like 1,000,000 hits. And he's like, I totally butchered it like usual, but yeah, no, it was. And then I told my buddy, I go, yo, I told my buddy Sean, my roommate, I go, this is what I do, dude. I'm always like a day or a week ahead of everyone, the whole goddamn world. I go, Bill Cosby, I go, this week is gonna get bombarded with rape cases, and literally within fucking 12 to 24 hours, there was like fucking 10 charges against him. Then there was like fucking 50 and 7. It's like, what, 70? That was just and then it's like, my buddy's like, damn, dude. And I do this shit all the time. I've done it for fucking years and years and years and years. I'm good at predicting shit like that.
Well, and you know what? The thing about comedy is, like, you have your people that, you know, they're like, okay, well, I'm going to just be, you know, a popular comedian, or I'm just going to do what the, you know, what's expected of me and go make people laugh. But there's also the people, the comedians out there that just, they poke the pig. They fucking, you know, they stir shit up, and it's, you know, where they're doing it in a comedic way, but it's not your standard. I mean, come on, you got Bill Hicks, Lenny Bruce, you know, like Lenny Bruce, you would, like, some people would just be like, well, you know, what the hell, what, or even Bill Hicks. Cause I mean, I never really liked Bill Hicks. Then I'm like, no, but he, you know, and then later on I'm like, oh, okay. I get what he's, you know, to understand what he was doing, you know, cause I saw him on Letterman one time when I was a kid. I'm like, this guy sucks. He's not even funny. But then, you know, I was a kid. I didn't know anything, you know? And then you start to figure out that, like, oh, shit, this is what he was doing.
Yeah, exactly. Antonio says, gonna drop in and listen while eating. All right, dude. Stick around, Antonio. Let's see here. So, like I said, I watched a lot of, I'd say 90% of Andy Kaufman's clips. And I've never seen him break character once. Maybe, no, see, even, here's the thing. Even the times when I thought that he broke character, he was playing me. Like, at the end of when he read The Great Gatsby to the university, the college crowd, literally the whole book, and there were still people, like, the whole entire place, he cleared out the whole entire room, and there was only, like, a couple people left at the end. And his voice is all raspy because he read the whole book. See, like me, I almost had tears in my eyes just thinking about it. But like, people are like, that's not funny. Like, to me, that's fucking hilarious. And especially when you look at the interview after, he goes and he's like, he goes in the back and he's all sweating and he's like, those fucking people, he's like, they didn't even fucking listen to me. They're all a bunch of jerks and they're mean. Did you hear them? Did you hear them? These fucking sons of, these jerk sons of bitches. And he's like, he gets all, and I'm like, and then I realized that he's fucking again. He's again, it's in another character. He's
it's wrestling. You know, it was wrestling.
Exactly. He's pretending that he's having a breakdown and getting angry and fucking animate and hostile. And that's what I do. Like, when I start getting mean and apparently full of hate and anger, it's like, dude, You're in my strings. I'm playing you. I'm playing you. Exactly. You think I'm some? I do have rage, and pain, and yes, okay, like, and anger, and hatred, but it's like it's a wind. It's a thought. It goes like the wind, and I don't mind channeling it and tapping into it. Supposedly, it's called acting, folks. You can act hostile, angry, and at the same time convey a very profound message, and not give a fuck if you think I'm the angry, hostile, ruthless person that I'm. At the same time, I am that, but I'm not that. If you met me in person, like Kyle McDonald did recently, he's like, we talked about it. He's like, it's so nice to meet somebody else who's real and face to face. And I don't even have to. I went over this a little bit with him, and he's like, "Yeah, dude." He's like, "It's like they don't understand." It's some people think I'm. I got called a fucking Islamic terrorist the other. She said terrorist. You're an Islamic terrorist. I'm like, you can't even spell terrorist correctly. It's like, oh my god. I wasn't even talking about God or religion. She just brought up. You're obviously some sort of Islamic terrorist, and I'm like, what?
What's that new word? Making up words now.
my friends come in and they're defending me, and man, they make me seem like fucking the Care Bears. They, you know, like they don't hold back, and I'm like, eesh, I feel guilty pressing the like button on their comment.
Well, you know, because people are like, oh, I hate that Dan. Why do you even fucking talk to him? Why do you hang out with him? I'm like, you just don't get it. I'm like, you don't understand. You know, like, I remember, like, the first time I met you, we had, like, you know, and then I got to know you. I'm like, I know, you know, this guy, he's not going to come and, oh, I'm so mad at you, I'm going to kick your door down. And like, I've had people say, I'm not going to watch your show if that guy's on it. And I'm like, well, there's other streams you could watch. Good, I'm unsubscribing. I'm like, then I don't want you. You know, because if it's my fucking show, so I'm going to put on whoever the fuck I want. I'm not going to let nobody dictate who comes on my streams. You know, I'll fucking put on some young guy or whatever the fucking the North Korean guy is. I'll have him on. You know, I don't give a shit.
Kim Jong-un.
Yeah, I'll have that guy on. I don't, you know, I'll have Putin on. I don't care. Whoever wants to come. I want them on. I'm putting them on. And if you don't like it, get the fuck out. You know.
Oh man, that's good.
That's the way I look at it.
Yeah, dude. Thanks, man. We've covered a lot of topics here. We still have some quotes a couple of quotes I want to read. A couple of things I want to show you. And I'll read some comments off. If anyone has any questions, go ahead and ask. I like it when the chat room is lively and you guys are like interacting with one another and the people on the panel or myself. I really enjoy that, if you haven't noticed. And so my drink is here. I'm going to need to recharge my cannabinoids.
Right on.
I'm going to go take a bong rip real quick, and I'll be right back in a minute. Hold on.
Okay. The Ranger is on. Well, we're going to look at the Ranger game, folks.
All right.
See what's going on in the fucking in the hockey game. All right, New York Rangers, first period just started. We're 3 seconds into the game, nothing. Rangers, Colorado, in the Madison Square Garden, home opener, folks. So we're in the neutral zone now. Rangers got the puck. Now we're in the Ranger zone. Defense has the puck. Tonight's going to be a wild night for New York fans. You got Rangers home opener, you know, opening game of the season, the first Ranger game of the season. And you got New York Yankees in the division round in Cleveland, best of 7. So there's a lot of see, this is my time here, you know, hockey and baseball. Baseball playoffs, hockey's first starting. You know, I used to love football. I really did. I had Giant season tickets for about 10 years. Had a great time being there and partying with all the folks and tailgate parties. But I can't do it anymore. Because when they wanted to build that new Giant Stadium, NFL has enough money to build a stadium in every town in this country. But they decided to make the taxpayers pay for the fucking stadium for two teams. They have the Jets and the Giants that play in a stadium, and those teams won't pay for it. The NFL won't pay for it. The taxpayers had to pay for it. And that's one of the reasons that I'm not in New Jersey anymore, because the fucking taxes are, oh, nice hit, are fucking ridiculous. I lived about 20 miles outside of New York City. So our taxes were fucking, and just the price, the markup on everything, just because, you know, you're living close to fucking New York. You know, it was, it's a lot. Ooh, look at that. Like, New York is that great. They fucking closed down all the, they turned New York into like a Disneyland. They call like all the cool fucking clubs to go see bands at, and now all like the smaller places have been taken over by fucking, you know, Live Nation, these corporate fucking things, and you know, so it just, I mean, I was always an underground, you know, CBG, Coney Island High, fucking Continental, ABC No Rio. Manitoba's bar, like that's the places I like to go and play and do all that stuff. But they're all gone now. So if you want to go see a band, you know, you got to go either way out to Brooklyn, or, you know, they just don't have. And a lot of the bands that I like, you know, those old school punk rock bands, they won't even come to the East Coast anymore. Because of all that bullshit, they just go out to the West Coast, because, you know, they still have places. Like if you want to go see, like the Subhumans, or if you want to go see, I don't know if the UK Subs are still touring, or if you want to see Addicts, or if you want to see, the Exploited don't come here. They hate us, and Waddy's all fucked up. But you know, any of those punk rock bands from Europe that, you know, that I grew up listening to, they don't come to the East Coast anymore. I mean, the Damned came and played on the East Coast, but they're kind of, you know, one of the bigger bands, and they, you know, they can make they play like the Stone Pony in Jersey, and they'll play like the theater here in Philly, and they'll play like in New York at like one of them theaters. I don't know. Like
one of those fucking, yeah, I know what you
mean. Yeah, like one of the mid-level fucking places, you know. But it's the day, yeah. You know, they're the first, they put out the first English punk rock record. So, I mean, and I have it right over there. I have the original fucking first pressing.
Yeah, do you see what I see?
I see the Pope and Hugh Hefner, and it's Pope is surrounded by nuns, and Hugh Hefner is surrounded by other nuns.
If you look closely, there's a bulge right here.
Hey, what's going on there, ma'am?
What's up with that, ma'am? But I want to just go through a couple of these. You ever see these things?
No, but that's like Star Trek shit. Waddy, it's too early.
I always knew slacking off would pay off.
Yeah, like, why do I need...
Praise Bob.
That's like some Star Trek.
Here, read that shit. That's a fucking,
yeah.
That's a life changer. I read that last night. I mean, it's. I forget how beautiful everything is, man. I really do. Like, the moment is like everything up to this last sentence that I'm just about to finish right now is completely known to me. I know I've known everything that we've been through that's brought us here is the known. And what's beyond that is called the unknown, which is where we're going. Well, some people stay in the known their whole lives, see? And because they're so tense and nervous and scared of the unknown, that they never take the jump and the leap into the unknown, which is right there next to the known. And so when an archer is, when I read these things, I catch myself like not appreciating the moment and not being grateful and relaxed and at ease and, appreciative. And it's really a very conscious and devoted thing to and it takes a lot of that action and consciousness to finally stop. Like you have to be full of action and doing, constantly do, collect and materialize and experience to finally just like, all right, dude. Like I don't need to, you know what I mean? So when an archer is shooting for fun, exactly, like when we were kids, fucking creating maps and creating superpowers and with our imaginations, when an archer is shooting for fun, he has all his skill. If he shoots for a brass buckle, he is already nervous. He shoots for a prize of gold, he goes blind or sees two targets. He is out of his mind. His skill has not changed, but the prize divides him. He cares. He thinks more of winning than of shooting. And the need to win drains him of power. And that's, I relate that to the comedic world. And that's why I don't do stand-up comedy, because I don't want the brass buckle or the gold or the fucking the prize. That's what the whole thing is. That's all about getting the fame and the power and the prize. And even the church's subgenius fills me up with slack, and it tells me to go after the fame and the success and the power and the money and everything. It tells me to do that. And I did for a little bit, but then, you know, you go through, you know, you realize you're just swimming in the dark through the river of tears. And it's just an endless battle of competition egos and all these individual egos you're surrounded by. I mean, dude, nobody liked to go on stage with me, fucking Jokerfish. Just like people are telling you, I don't like to talk to him or listen to him. Well, how do you think it felt with other comedians when I was revealing their act before they did it? But I would go on stage and go, well, this dude's going to say these jokes. And this guy, this one guy, he's super jealous of me. And this is how he acts. Watch these jokes that he's going to say. And it's like I would ruin their acts, and the whole night would be ruined. And half the crowd would leave, and the other half would stay and be laughing. And that half would be divided, and there'd be a half that liked me and a half that didn't. It's like, well, I can't please everybody. I'm sorry. But it's so interesting that I've been kicked out of comedy clubs, like kicked directly off of stage by the security officer or by the bouncers and the security guards, and told never to come back, and I'm permanently banned. And and I've had my family members watch it. Like my family members were there watching it one time, and I was like, the guy tried to put his hands on me after I got on the stage, and they were like, I was walking back, and people were like, they were like men and women patting me on the back as I was walking through the crowd. And I knew that I was going to get kicked off. The bouncer was there waiting for me. And he tried to put his hands on me. And I'm like, dude, I'm like, don't fucking touch me, man. And I go, I gotta go say goodbye to my family. And I went back up on the balcony where they were sitting. And I'm like, yeah, I'm getting thrown out of this place right now as we speak, but I'm really happy you guys came. And it was just funny. Like, they're like, what? Why? It wasn't that bad. And I'm like, I made fun of the wrong people. I made fun of you're not supposed to make fun of the venue and the security guard in at the beginning of the place and the bartenders. I was just it's tearing the whole place apart and make fun of how unprofessional and disgusting the place was. And, Yeah, they don't like that, obviously. You're not supposed to do that. That's literally like a rule of comedy in stand-up is you don't do that. And it's, I mean, I was talking about religion, growing up a Catholic. I was quoting some George Carlin. I predicted the presidency. It was between Mitt Romney, Newt Gingrich, and Obama for the second time. And I'm like, you really think that Newt Gingrich or Mitt Romney has a chance to become the president? I'm like, obviously Obama's gonna win again. And it's just like, the whole thing is just fucking a shit show. It's all a big show here. So this is.
Oh, there's Andy Kaufman. 1982. Wow.
He died shortly after, within the year. Well, supposedly.
You know, I don't watch like any modern shows. The only thing I watch is sports and like old shows. And I watch Taxi like every Sunday. And, what a great show that was, first of all. But, his Delacia character and then the woman who played like his wife or his girlfriend, and she kind of did the first voice, the way that they played off each other, I thought was really good. But going back to the, when you were on stage, I got to send you a video of the old band playing. And we've been kicked out of fucking – I was banned from the Stone Pony. I wasn't even allowed to go there. But it's changed owners like 100 times since then. We were kicked out of this place in Pennsylvania. We were kicked out of – we got thrown out of the Scum Fest. How do you get kicked out of the Scum Fest? So I got to send you – so because we were just making waves, and that's, you know, we weren't there reaching for the brass ring. We weren't there to make money. We weren't there. We were just there to fucking do what was in our heads, you know, and amuse ourselves. And it's funny because even Karen goes, I remember you guys. Like, cause I said, oh, Karen, you know, you like punk rock here. Check this out. She goes, I remember you guys. And then she goes, she was laughing. I'll send you one of the videos, man. I'll send you one of the short ones. You'll get it.
Absolutely.
You'll understand what we're doing. Like, you'll get it. A lot of people just didn't get it. You know, they didn't understand what we were doing. Because it was around the time, you know, it was in the 90s and like everybody's like, oh, Green Day and punk rock and like, you know, and we're like, no. We love the Germs, the Sex Pistols, the fucking, like, all, like, the, you know, like, the Exploited.
Social Misfits.
Yeah, fucking Misfits, like, all that shit, man. We're out there to just, you know, just make waves, rattle the cage, shake the tree. It became, like, punk rock became, like, a safe haven for, you know, like, oh, well, I want to be weird and different. It's like, nah, like, we're fucked up. And you're going to have to deal with it.
Well, these witches and warlocks that surround us in Hollywood, in religion, and all different types of things.
Government, everything.
Yeah, exactly. Fucking everything. I can go on forever about that. I'm not gonna, but they're just jealous egos. Could you mute yourself, bro? They're just jealous egos that, like, if you go in the room and it's like the Sopranos, like the head boss from like 20 years ago wants to come back into the fucking business, and Tony, being the head boss of Jersey, he's like, all right, I'll cut you a fucking deal. You'll get 20% and just don't step on my toes or anybody else's toes. And all of a sudden, this motherfucker is back with the boys and around poker and all the operations, and fucking just running his mouth nonstop, telling stories that aren't funny, just nonstop, never getting anybody else a chance to talk, tell their stories, and fucking and Tony, it's like. These are fucking – Tony realizes he has like an existential crisis. Tony looks because his wife Carmela's like, Tony, you think you're hanging around a bunch of fucking flunkies and fucking who are laughing at your jokes and fucking telling you you're not bald and complimenting your shoes, and she's like, you're a fucking joke, and like, there's only like two people in the world that can tell that type of shit to Tony, which is his wife and fucking the psychiatrist that he sees. And so like Tony is sitting there playing poker with these fucking stumads, and what is that? Is that the correct word? Stunads or stumads? Stunads. Stunads. He has an existential crisis because what his wife said to him makes perfect sense, and all these fucking idiots are chiming in with their complimenting him, and he's like, everything's in slow motion to him, and he's looking around, he's like, oh fuck, he's like, she's right, and he's like, total panic attack, and it's I've had those experiences in my life, so it's fucking, if you love yourself, you love others. If you hate yourself, you hate others. In relationships with others, it is only you, mirrored. Here's one for you, Jokerfish, and the listeners. Do not personally give any more conscious consideration to events that you do not want to happen. Any such concentration, to whatever degree, ties you in with those probabilities. So concentrate upon what you want. And as far as public events are concerned, take it for granted that sometimes even men are wiser than they know. And that last part is very mysterious. I think that gives a lot of optimism and hope that there are secret people out there, like men and women, that are unbelievably wise and they don't even know it. That's how I interpret that, at least.
Well, you know, people that they'll just say something, you're like, how did you, like, and you know, just like regular, you know, but they say something that's so profound, so brilliant, and you're like, man, you know, like, how did you come up with that? And it might just be one time in their life that they said something like that, but it's just you know, I just believe that there's, you know, everybody. I don't care if you're you know, your Down syndrome, you're autistic, if you're, you just, I think everybody has something that makes them smart. You know, everybody's smart. And that's what I saw in the movie today. And it's called Bang the Drum Slowly, with Robert De Niro and Michael Moriarty, because Robert De Niro's character was just a dim-witted, you know, ball player. And he's like, well, I'm just not smart. He goes, everybody's smart. And he goes, you bought, you know, this insurance. And what you have to do is, you're a good hitter, but you have to be a smart hitter. And then, you know, he said, okay. But, you know, it's true. Everybody's smart. I don't care if you have an IQ of 10 million or an IQ of 2. Everybody's fucking smart and got something that they can offer that nobody else can offer.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so Dan, can you survive without me for like a few minutes? I got to take the fucking dog out.
Yeah, of course, dude.
All right, man. I'll be back.
All right. Let's see here. Ooh, now this is a fucking dig. A lot of women will hurry into a relationship with a boyfriend, quote unquote, just to get that quick D fix in them. Listen, I get it. You can't go 2 months without D. You have a mental issue. Good luck finding true love, pseudo-spiritual women. Happy National Boyfriend Day. My news feed consists of fear-mongering false flags, pseudoscience, and jumped-up egotistical idiots pretending to be spiritual. dude, it's hilarious. Sure, I've got the elevator footage of a 64-year-old retiree lugging 10 rifles and hundreds of rounds of ammo up to his hotel room, and it's gone. Victoria has a secret. None of these lingerie models are women. They use fallen angel symbolism for a reason. Victoria's secret is a big cabaret show. Help! Help, I need help, I'm drowning. Oh no, that is terrible. My thoughts and prayers are with you. But I'm drowning, help me, thoughts and prayers. Please help me, thoughts and prayers. Thoughts and prayers, I just can't get you. Thoughts and prayers, I can't help you. How about you reach your hand out and fucking help him instead of just fucking thoughts and prayers? It's good to be king, even just for a while. Never go cold, you gotta smile. It's good to be king, even just for a bit. You talk real loud, and then you tone yourself down. So let's see here. Keeping this shit real, do I ruffle your feathers? Good. I have no mercy for your ignorance. Today, yesterday, or tomorrow, or ever. I don't give a fuck, because I want y'all to wake the fuck up. You are in the no-safe zone. Welcome to the old world order, motherfucker. I have all of San Diego's best globehead comedians stalking me. It's amazing their level of obsession. Playing you like puppets on a string, because that's what you are. Muppets on a string. Oh, boy. Because I won't back down, and I stand my ground. I'm gonna keep on kicking you motherfuckers round. Called it. I want back, hey, baby. There ain't no easy way out. I want back, hey, you understand my now. Cause I won't back down. All right, let's, Jesus. Where are the bodies? Any body cam footage? Yeah, this was in the morning. I couldn't sleep that day. You guys believe anything the TV says because your soul and brain have been taken away from you. All right, I'm going to hand out this link to some friends. I'm gonna pass this link to some buddies. Gonna keep on something here. Even though this world keeps pushing me around, gonna stand my ground. Cause I won't back down. There ain't no easy way out, and I won't back down. There ain't no easy way out. Let's see what we got going on here. I'm big. Oh my god, your questions are so dumb. Not you talking to somebody in particular. Who's who? Hey, what's up, White Angel? Who's the one that likes Alan Watts? I love Alan Watts. White Angel. Sounds like a Power Ranger name. Let's see here. One of the most powerful statements I've heard. Hurt people. Yes, that is true. Cindy Pritchard. I've been guilty of that. Yes. Obviously. Live stream and Alan Watts tape today on Buddhism. It's only 360. 3 minutes. Wait. I don't know. And have to render 360. And have to render that. Oh, okay, cool. Takes 5 or so hours. Okay, cool. New Landy. Tom's stuck in your head. Yeah, Felix. Oh, I know what I'm gonna play. Orson interviews himself about Andy Kaufman while Andy watches. All right, well, we're definitely watching. Definitely watching this.
Dada.
Check this shit out. This is Orson Welles interviewing Andy Kaufman in 1982 next to the fourth Ghostbuster. So let's see here.
Did you see my comedic spaceman?
actually, I didn't. Sorry, man. Everybody else did, probably.
Hey, everybody, man.
I've seen that a million. I've seen that a million times. You ass.
I got the like. This is a GI Joe, and it came with like the space capsule that the you know the man on the moon and.
So, could you see this?
Yeah, that's that guy, that scientist, right? Or is that Ron Glass from Barney Miller?
Yeah, that's fucking Ron Glass, dude. That's the fucking that's the fourth Ghostbuster right there. Yeah, actually, he just died recently, within the past year and a half.
I know, man. I was a huge fan of his. I was a huge fan. I loved him ever since Barney Miller.
I totally have a really good respect for him since he didn't say a fucking word and interrupt these two geniuses that you're about to see. Like that's. He has a comedic he has just an understanding here to not interrupt the what's going on between these two. Did you see this yet, Jokerfish?
No, I haven't seen it.
Okay, yeah, I'm gonna play this and go pour myself a drink.
Right on.
So this is a 1982. Actually, they both Andy Kaufman would die supposedly, quote unquote, or fake his death within the next year. Of a lung cancer, and then Orson. Well, actually, nah, he didn't smoke too much. Yeah, you're right. I thought that he did smoke a little bit. I think he might have smoked in the beginning of his career, but I'll have to. I think I'm wrong about that. But I know that he didn't smoke like much at all. So that's really weird. But so let's see here. So yeah, I'm gonna fucking. I'm just gonna fucking play it. You understand it. You get it. I don't need anybody else to get it. This is just pure brilliance. Enjoy.
Better. Wrong. How about that? There's a trick to being a host, and I'll catch on to it before we're done. I hope you're enjoying yourself as much as I am. We're going to be meeting now somebody I don't know, except from the tube, from one of the other shows, which has kept television from being a criminal felony. I think it's a wonderful show, Taxi. Don't you like it?
Quite relevant, eh, Jokerfish? Jokerfish.
It is, man. It really is. And you know what's funny? Because I don't know if you've ever watched Barney Miller, but that's a brilliant show, too.
Yeah. You're going to love this, man.
He also made a very considerable name for himself before a Taxi ever happened as a comedian. And he's a man of many personalities and surprises. God knows what he has in store for us now. Mr. Andy Kaufman.
Mm-hmm.
know how your head is.
Oh, it's,
somebody just said that.
It's healing very well.
It's healing very well.
Yeah.
You want to talk about wrestling, don't you?
Well, actually, not anymore.
I'm delighted to hear that.
What, you don't like wrestling?
No, but I heard you talking about wrestling on another talk show.
Yeah.
So I thought it'd be nice to talk about you.
Okay. I could talk about it if you want.
About wrestling.
If you'd like. I'll talk about anything you'd like to talk about.
I'm fascinated. I'm fascinated by all the characters you do. And the other night I saw on Taxi a scene taking place in the native country of whatever, wherever it is, Gondolivia. Of your, the basic character you play in Taxi. What is the name of that country?
There's no
there's name. No name. That's better than
that. Call it Latka Land.
Yeah, all right. What was so great about it? Did you see that scene? It was a whole, it was like a whole feature movie in 6 minutes of life and death in the lower Slobovia. What was so great about it was that you played it very straight. With tremendous sincerity, as though you had Ibsen on your hands and not a lot of comedy writers, and it gave it a very curious resonance, and it was one of the best things I've seen in a long time.
Thank you.
Yeah, it really was, and all those characters are great. I want to know why it is that you go and wrestle with people, but you can act so well.
I always liked wrestling. Until this happened.
Yes.
But now I don't like it anymore.
You don't like it. Look, it would seem to me that although acting is a dangerous business, wrestling might become a little monotonous.
Well, it
one wasn't. Broken neck after another.
That's true.
Yeah. Your group in Taxi is full of some of the most talented people in show business. It's almost unbelievably loaded with talent. But it only occasionally seems to be an ensemble show to me. It seems a little like a Catherine wheel in which everybody's blowing off in wild directions. It's part of the charm of it. And I think partly too because of the set, which doesn't contain you, doesn't make a community of you. There you are, coming in from nowhere and drifting out again and so on. And it's perfectly adapted to your character because nobody ever came from nowhere more completely than... You know, when I first used to see you on television, when you were doing that basic character, I thought that was all you could do. I didn't know you had another voice.
Oh, I do.
Yeah, I know you do.
Wow. Yeah.
Where did you find that original voice?
I don't know. I grew up in New York, and you hear a lot of different voices in New York. And
you don't hear that one.
I think I had a high school friend talked like that, and also a college roommate talked like that.
I just met him.
A high school friend was from him. South America, a college roommate was from Iran. And I guess the two...
Not only did I find my first cousin last night, I found this guy that he's talking about last night.
Awesome. Now, Dan, was it the high school friend or the college friend that you met?
The college friend.
Okay.
He's like, that is me, and I can prove it. I'm like, yo, upload the fucking proof, bro. I need to see that shit. And it really is him, though. I know it is.
Ooh, it turned out. Well, actually, there was other people. Let me see. I knew another guy from, I don't know what other country, but just a blend of all the people from other countries that I heard, and I blended them all together and came up with that voice.
Yeah, sure. It's a boy. Is that a blend?
People from other countries that I heard, and I blended them all together and came up with that voice.
Yeah, sure, it's a boy. Is that a
I love the eyebrow raise.
And it's fascinating. I don't know whether it's the innocence of the fellow or the feeling you have that he is not stupider than everybody, but maybe smarter, that adds to the fascination. How long did you play him before Taxi?
Oh, it was one of the first characters I ever did. The first character I ever did was my imitation of Elvis Presley.
Yes, I've seen that. That's great. Yeah. That's great.
Next character, the after Elvis Presley was that character.
Yeah.
Of course, the third character was well, he wasn't a character. There's a lot of debate about whether it's a character or a real guy. That's Tony Clifton.
Yes, yeah. That's a whole other stuff. That's metaphysics.
Yeah.
Metaphysics, he says.
So those are the three early ones.
Yeah. Now, you, for a while, it looked like we weren't going to have Taxi anymore, but we are, aren't we?
Yes.
That's good. I'm glad we are. There's something to look forward to.
So, I think that's fucking incredible.
I mean, having you know, Orson Welles interview. Now, was he filling in for David Letterman, or was he filling in? That didn't look like the Johnny Carson set.
I think that was Merv Griffin.
Oh, okay, Merv Griffin. Okay.
That was for Merv Griffin there. And out of all, like I said, I the only people who have seen that video on is Antonio that I know of, the guy you talked to, Antonio Superdutz.
Yeah.
And and he watched it like a week ago, and I just found it, of course, last night, and I found a lot of stuff last night. It's totally mind blowing and. Totally synchronistic, and I, like I said, I've seen like 95% of Andy Kaufman's clips, and I've never ever seen him break character. Like behind the stage of the interview, and after he got done with The Great Gatsby, was the closest I've seen him to breaking character. Even though I think that was the whole point. I was another character, and this was the very first time I've ever seen Andy Kaufman break character. He was totally himself. And he even told secrets, and the reason why was because he was in the presence of a hero of his and a genius, and Orson Welles was one of the very few people on the plane that actually understood what was going on, what he was doing with everyone, you know what I mean?
But, you know, that's the thing, is because some people, I mean, don't understand a lot of, you know, the way these comedians are, or the way certain entertainers are, that, but they don't care. You know, all they want to do is like, well, I want to see Kevin Hart and laugh. And, you know, now Kevin Hart's funny and all, but he's just not, you know, I'm not going to sit there and, you know, watch a whole Kevin Hart special. You know, I'd rather watch an old school Dice or Eddie Murphy special, but, you know, but I like the, like Norm, I love Gilbert Gottfried. Because those guys fuck with you, and those are the comedians I like. Those are the entertainers I like, are the ones that are up there for themselves, and they laugh at you. And they'll, like Norm Macdonald will bomb on purpose. He'll go out and just,
yeah, exactly.
You know, he'll just go out and like he was doing a roast, and he just read the most hackiest fucking jokes.
I know, dude.
You know. And my friend Lisa, hi Lisa, if you're watching, worked at a comedy club in Canada and came there one night. She showed me a picture, she ended with Norm, and she said he bombed and everybody got pissed off and wanted their money back and just took off on their bill. But I was like, he did that on purpose. You know, like that's what he, like sometimes he'll do that, you know, like he'll just be like, you know what, I just feel like he's just, you know, like hit the way this guy, I think Norm is like really smart, and he just, you know,
oh, he is, man.
Do you ever see that podcast he does now?
Yeah, dude, I've been binge watching that. That's my new favorite show, dude. I've been binge watching that, man.
I mean, and he'll do the jokes, and he'll hand jokes to the other, like to the guest, and he'll give him like the worst jokes, and they're like, "I'm not saying this. I'm not saying this."
No, he always ends up making him do it, but. He's a good, like, good sidekick. I understand his patheticness. I just watched the Jim Carrey one. He just had Jim Carrey on.
Oh yeah.
And I watched that, and that was incredible, dude. And Jim Carrey totally pegged Norm Macdonald down. He did an impression of him, and and he was like, "What did he say? You just reminded me of it." Oh, he's like, Jim Carrey's like, oh, he's like, I see what you're doing. He's like, you like to break everyone down and bring bring the whole place down with you. And he's like, and then you like to build it back up. And it's, yeah. So, and Jim Carrey's like, you enjoy that. So it was so cool to see the psych. Like, I'm interested. I watch behaviors and the body language. I've been studying that like my whole life. I'm very, and I've had to be aware of that with some of my jobs, teaching these kindergartners all the way up to 18-year-olds who are in wheelchairs and fucking with those fucking handy sticks, paralyzed legs and Tourette syndrome and foreign kids and what was I saying here? What were we just talking about? Shit! Oh, I lost it again. What were we talking about? Something about Norm and you muted yourself. Oh, unmute yourself. Hold on. You got to unmute yourself.
We were talking about, like Norm MacDonald and the comedians that, like, so, well, I like to break it down and, bring everything down and then build it back up. And,
yeah, like the behavior of these, like, you have to know the behavior of these kids, like, know that they're about to go AWOL. Like, they're about to have a freak out. Like, this kid or girl is going to about to freak out and she's going to cause trouble with the other kids. And, like, dude, I've been around these kids who are fucking, nearly 400-pound 13-year-olds and fucking 6'6" fucking, 12-year-olds and fucking, 13-year-olds and their parents are just, and they're all split up and they're in gangs and drugs. And so, like, they go to that, they send their kids to the bad kid school where all the misfits go and shit. But it's like a good thing. It really is. And people like me, well, my brother was doing it before me. My brother was a teacher there before I was. And then he obviously passed away. And then all of a sudden the principal of the school reached out to me and was like, yeah, you can do this, and you can be a teacher's aide. And I'm like, shit, yeah, I can. And I did, and oh wow, man, that really, whew, that fucking saved my psyche, man. Freaking all of a sudden being around all these kids who used to know my brother and they looked up to him as a hero, and they're like, and they gave me like presents and stuff, like letters and cards. And it's just, I collected it all. It's mind blowing. And that really shows you like the psychology of how rough people have it. And like people have it so much worse than us. And like we really got to realize that, and so if we just make little changes, we can do something about it. And so like I just find it interesting studying Jim Carrey's behavior and how he's studying Norm MacDonald's behavior, and it's very, it's like. I do that with everyone. Like Robert Anton Wilson and Terrence McKenna were like good friends and smoked weed together, and they seem to really enjoy one another. But then you have people. I heard the story when Robert Anton Wilson met Philip K. Dick, and Philip K. Dick thought they both were like completely wary of one another and unsure of one another because they're both science fiction authors. They both claim to have been in contact with a higher intelligence from the Sirius star system, an extraterrestrial intelligence from the Sirius star system, both of them, a dog alien, and it just gets really bizarre because Terrence McKenna was talking about this, like everyone who I know who takes shit seriously has some sort of ET contact experience, and not just like some dilly dally woohoo. Oh yeah. Some weird little, like, I can tell, it's not some thing where you're walking down the street and you're like, oh, hey, Mr. E.T. Maybe that can happen. Sure. If you're a little kid and you have innocence, you know what I mean? You ever hear stories of little kids? Like they always see shit and go, oh yeah, yeah. Exactly. 'Cause they're pure and uncorrupted. But like, people like us, we need like 5 grams of mushrooms or three giant rips of DMT to fucking get in contact with these beings. And that's all it takes. You want to meet some of these things? Go ahead and take your 5 grams of psilocybin mushrooms in silent darkness and you're gonna meet God. You're gonna shake his hand or her hand, and 5 grams or 3 rips of DMT or more, and you're gonna see multiple entities. You're gonna see.
I don't know what DMT is.
Dimethyltryptamine.
Is it like somebody smoking a bong or
Well. Technically, you can do it in a lot of different ways. You can put the DMT crystals into a pill, a nice little, and then swallow it and put the pill in the water and just drink it. You know, that's totally natural too. By the way, DMT is the natural drug chemical that is created from the pineal gland. And that's what induces our dreams every night. Psychedelic dreams are, that's how the, so it's like a natural DMT, and we sleep and then we have those crazy dreams. And that's because every night we're excreting the natural DMT that our metabolism produces.
Well, it's DMT. Does that come from like a, cause, oh shit. And on TV, it comes from like the root of like a tree or something? I was watching a Vice, you know, that Vice.
Yep.
And they were talking about like ecstasy or something, talking about the Molly, whatever the fuck. Is that an ingredient in that? Or
yeah, I got you. Well, the ayahuasca is a root plant.
Okay.
I'm sure you've heard of ayahuasca, right?
Yeah.
So the ayahuasca is a root from a tree found in the jungles of the Amazon and other places, I'm sure. And what you're talking about is actually a plant, a green plant, leaves. And you take these leaves. It has two words, one word and another word, something. I can't remember. But that plant has DMT in it. So DMT is found naturally throughout nature, everywhere. Actually, I mean, you can actually extract DMT from fucking grass if you really wanted to get technical. One of my friends, when I was in my early 20s. When I was in my mid-20s, after my mushroom experiments, and he got a frog from the Amazon, and he was raising it, or a toad, and toads and frogs, and he was fucking extracting the DMT that's found that the frogs excrete naturally.
And, like on The Simpsons, you ever see Homer when he left and then Homer's like licking the frog and his eyes look it out.
That's definitely pointing to that. It really is. That's the symbolism, the connection there. And he wanted to use me as his guinea pig to do the DMT, the frog toad DMT. I actually didn't do that, but I found DMT the regular way, which is just it looks like if you pull a beautiful crystalline earwax, and it's a beautiful crystalline earwax. You're like, ooh, what's this thing? It looks like crack almost, but it's the opposite of it. It's so funny because like some people are like, ugh, like that's so disgusting, like what a user drug head. And it's like, so you're scared of meeting the mother goddess of all that controls the universe, Okay, well, that's your own fault. I've been hugged and held by her, and I got to look at her even though she told me not to.
You'll go to church every week. You'll go to church every week and pray and give all your money or give your money to the thing, but you don't want to. Well, it's up to you.
So Terrence McKenna says, going to the cradle to the grave without a DMT or a mushroom experience is like going to the cradle to the grave without a sexual experience. He's like, you missed out. You missed the whole point of it. The whole point was that you do these things.
Now, is it legal or is it like?
Oh, no, it's totally, it's a Schedule 1.
Well, that's.
It's completely harmless, too, like cannabis. It's never killed anybody. It's impossible to die off of mushrooms, DMT, or weed. Can't do it. You can't overdose off of. I mean, you could try, but you're going to come back to reality. You can literally take a fucking bucket full of fucking mushrooms, and you ain't gonna die. You're just gonna puke your brains out and shit your brains out is all you're gonna fucking do. And you'll be tripping for a solid 24 hours, but you'll come back to fucking reality.
Well, did you ever see that show Metalocalypse, the cartoon? And they went to Dopo, and they were like, you know, they're in like the jungle. They're like, they got Yopo, and they were like blowing it in their face. There's a documentary. It's one of the Trailer Park Boys like characters who play, you know, Don or Donna. His name is like,
I love that guy.
Guinness. He did it's called Trippin' with Lee.
And he I watched it.
Yeah, like where he
goes. I watched it. It was amazing.
Yeah, it really was. And Josh interviewed him. When he was, you know, kind of promoting it, and he was like, Josh was like, yeah, I just took some acid, and Lee was tripping.
I think they both take acid.
Yeah, they were both tripping, and then they did, Josh interviewed him again, and he was like, he was tripping and painting, because that, like, Lee will do that, like, he does paintings, and then they auction them off for charity and stuff, and, you know, so he did a painting, like, live with Josh or something like that. It was it was a crazy documentary, man. I thought, you know, it was crazy.
My mind was blown.
You know, and just the fact that, you know, like he went out there and experienced all this stuff, and you know,
it takes honest bravery, courage, and testicular fortitude.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think I could do that. Like, just go off into the jungle and be around, you know, these villagers and natives and just experience something when you're totally out of your own element. Like, you know, it's one thing to take mushrooms and, you know, hang out in, like, in familiar territory. But it's another thing to go and experience this stuff that you've never done before in an environment you've never been to before, in a culture you've never been around. And that's something that's... You know, that's a pioneer to me, you know. You know, it's like a Lewis and Clark thing.
What's his face? Russell Brand was on Joe Rogan's podcast today. I'm going to have to check that out.
I like Joe Rogan. He's, he looks like he's a dickhead. But, you know, he gives people fair, you know, he'll give people time to talk, you know, and he'll put people on that he doesn't necessarily like agree with or whatever. And I used to like that show he was on, News Radio. That was a great show.
Oh, okay.
You know, it had Phil Hartman, it was a really good show. It was really, and he was really good on it. And I hear he's a really good stand-up. I've never seen any of his stand-up stuff. But
who's that again?
Joe Rogan.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I've seen him recently. Yeah, you know that. Yeah, I saw him recently. I saw him a couple months ago. And he was standing with me for most of the show. Because I had a photo. I had a shirt on.
And he, you know what, I was he had like a fighter on one time, you know, he's like in the UFC and all that. And the guy was like, he was a Japanese American, but he was like, he was over in Japan,
and he got busted for weed, and weed's a big deal in Japan. I mean, they put Paul McCartney in jail for it. But, you know, I think he does really good interviews, man. I do.
Yeah, he does. I just pick any person I like, I just watch that interview.
Yeah, I for some reason I thought you didn't like him because of his the flat earth thing where he was kind of like,
yeah, he helps push it along. I know he's a globe, a round earth shill, but he's going to come along. I have faith in him.
But that's what I like about him is he'll put, you know, like flat earthers on the show where some people will be like, nah, I'm not even going to do that.
Well, the only reason why he has a flat earth talk is because his best friend is Eddie Bravo, and Eddie Bravo is a flat earther.
Oh, so he'll
Eddie always just trolls him and will fucking, he'll throw that in, and Joe will troll Eddie with, you know, pictures of fake fucking CGI shit and like, and they just both do it to each other now.
Oh, so they go back and forth and play with each other.
Yeah. And Alex Jones is now in the midst of it too.
Yeah, Alex Jones, I don't know how I feel about that guy. I honestly don't know enough about him. I remember is Geraldo was doing a show and he was there with a bullhorn and a bunch of people and they were fucking up the show. And Geraldo was like, oh, it's just some rabble rousers.
You see that?
Yeah, that's Leahy.
Shit tectonics. Do you know what happens when two shit plates collide? It's a shit quake, Randy.
Well, you know, it's great. I think it was on the Trailer Park Boys podcast where he's like, they're like, Ricky, you believe the earth is flat? He goes, it could be. You know, and like just in that, and I remember what you said. It's like, you know, that dumb character, and it's kind of bringing it into the consciousness of everybody.
Exactly.
But it was just funny because I love Ricky. He's just that character is so fucking funny.
Yeah, man, I love the new season within the month.
Yeah, it's gonna be Out of the Park. I think is coming up. It's called
Yes,
Out of the Park, and then the next one it'll be season 12. And again, my friend Lisa. Hi, Lisa, if you're watching. She sent in, they had a contest, like a fan contest, like you send in, like, you know, like a piece of art or something, and they'll use it on the show, and she's a stained glass artist, and she made, like, a kitty cat nightlight that's stained glass, and won, so she got, like, a free year of SwearNet, and her nightlight is going to be on the show.
Let's see here. From depressed to deep rest. The word depressed is spoken phonetically as deep rest. We can choose to view depression not as a mental illness, but on a deeper level as a profound and very misunderstood state of deep rest entered into when we are completely exhausted by the weight of the false self, the man-made story of who we are. See, people are totally wrapped up in their stories, and I was, and I still am a little bit. I'm just the more I tell my stories and get all of my fucking story out, so I never have to fucking tell it ever again and just live a story instead of fucking telling it. My life is based on a true story, so it's gonna be a good one. So let's see here. Ooh, that one's a good one. My thoughts and prayers are with everyone who thinks these terrorism events are real. You are being psychologically abused. He's true. He's not fucking around there. It's good to be king, even just for a while. It's good to be king. That sounds so good.
That is, man. It's like running through my head. But, you know, like I said before, like I think everybody should have at least a couple hours where they feel like, you know, they feel like they, you know, they're the king, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Even just for a while. Yeah, even just for a while, he said, so.
Yeah, so check out the stadium. Actually, one other time, we got free tickets to a Rolling Stones concert. All we had to do was pick up my buddy's mother, And they had a box at, you know, a luxury box at Giant Stadium. So we got to sit like front row at the luxury box, free food, free booze. And it was in 94, because I remember it was the day before Woodstock 94. We got home from the Stone show, packed our shit up, and went up to Woodstock.
Nice.
Buddy, it was crazy, man. What a crazy.
Oh, this is.
I don't even think I.
Dude, this is fucking.
Woodstock.
Sorry. Go ahead. Now, I kind of had a fucking mind blower here. Check this shit out. So I'll go to fucking Bullseye. Hold on a sec. Bullseye. Board. Now, my buddy Mehmet DVG, he runs a show called The Koch on YouTube. Conscious Minds TV, I think his channel's called on YouTube. And he brought this to my attention, which really fucking blew my mind. And this is a flat Earth model, the bullseye. X marks the spot. Got to get to the center of the North Pole. And guess what? You want to know all the hidden lands beyond here? This is our Earth. And then guess what? There's another world beyond that Earth. And then there's another world beyond that. And another beyond that. And another beyond that. And another beyond that. And another beyond that. And there's white all around. And that's the fucking, the ice wall or whatever. And the infinite ice wall that could be there. But that really blew my mind. And, I thought that was fucking extremely interesting. And also, you were talking about Metalocalypse, and look at, you remember you were talking about Metalocalypse?
That show was really fucking crazy, where they had shadow government.
Okay, now watch this shit. So see what it says here? Falkenbach will soon thrive.
Yeah.
And now look, see how it says the world and the shit beyond the things surrounding it.
Yep.
Now and this in the middle. Now listen to what they say.
General, Death Talk has moved back to Earth and is on the verge of releasing a new weapon. General Proya. In addition,
the explosion has begun dating. I'm gonna put the subtitles up. Where the fuck are the subtitles? Fuck. Can you hear it? Well, you'll hear it.
Historically, dating a fan has proven to be catastrophic.
Yes. Gives me pause the explosion romantic, but Dr. Torment Bin McMillan. Dr. McMillan.
Magnum explosion is cursed by
God. Wait for it.
In this case, he's involved in the worst relationship known to mankind. He's begun seriously dating one of his wretched, mindless fans. A lasting, pathetic effort to avoid intimacy. These fan of mine's pretend relationship has the illusion of working. But when the celebrity wants out, the results can be quite dangerous.
Jesus Christ,
the economy is growing stronger thanks to the anticipation of Death Clocks coming out. And soon, that money will flow into Falkenbach like a general. Your moment to shine is coming.
All my lobbying efforts will come to fruition. The biggest defense of all time is passed on Congress.
We are on the precipice of something great. Falkenbach will soon try and ride.
That shit's fucked up. Falkenbach will soon thrive. Like, what the fuck am I inside of here?
Like, when you first saw that and you saw your name on there, like, you must have been like,
wait, my mind is still blown right now. Like, I'm like, what? I'm like, what? What the? Like, what?
You know, and I always, like, you know, I always watched, you know, I used to love Adult Swim. Now, I don't know. I don't really watch it anymore. I'm too wrapped up in fucking like horror movie, like, you know, like, I mean, like old school horror movies and old school TV shows, like, you know, Mannix and stuff like that, and the Night Stalker. But you know, I would watch these shows, get super high and watch these shows, and it was just entertainment. But now that you're showing me that, like, they're sending messages out, you know. I mean, I don't know if they're real or if they're just, you know, creations, but they're really trying to say something. You know, and you know,
yeah.
Simpsons has done some crazy things where, you know, where they're like, oh, we're
oh
going.
Oh, my God. The Simpsons has predicted everything.
9/11. And then there was one where Lisa Simpson was president and Trump was president. Like, Trump was the president before Lisa Simpson was president. And, like, oh, I have to fix Trump's economy.
And that was Hillary Clinton. Like, this Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump.
Yeah. I mean, so Lisa Simpson is going to be our next president. Woo!
You also had that Simpsons scene in the elevator with Donald Trump going down the elevator and the dude dropped a sign and it was the same thing happened. Remember that? Did you see that? Oh, dude, I'm putting that right now. You never saw that?
I don't think so.
Oh, dude, I'm putting that shit on right now. I'm going to put that on and then go pour a drink. And honestly, talk about whatever the hell anybody else wants to talk about. If they want to ask us any questions or talk about anything, we'll read some comments and then shut this off whenever the fuck we want to go watch our fucking shit or make some food or I don't know. Maybe I'll just make some food and fucking keep it going. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see what happens. But it'll be going for at least another 25 minutes.
Sounds good.
Maybe. I mean, maybe I'll keep it going. I don't know. We'll see. But
I sent out some packages and they were received, so I'm gonna have to be talking. Everybody wants to open their package with me. Like I sent out you know, to my future ex-wife, I sent a fucking package, and then I sent to Cone, my buddy. I just gathered up, he's a coin collector, and I just gathered up all these pennies.
Yeah.
I mean, so we're gonna kinda go over them together.
That's funny because my neighbor just is a coin collector too, and he just told me to start collecting pennies for him.
Really?
Yeah, like 3 days ago.
You should come and hang out on with us because we do a lot of chats where, like, we're going through like coins. Dacone loves coins, and I'm like, yeah, I'll do a stream. You know, he's just doing all that.
I see him doing that, but he puts that shit on like late at night, right when I'm about to go to bed, and. But yeah, I'll go on one of those. But what was I just about to put on real quick?
The Simpsons.
Donald Trump.
Elevator.
Oh, dude, you're about to be mind blown. Simpsons, Donald Trump, elevator scene. All right, check this shit out. Yeah, this is fucking crazy. Oh, no, you asshole. I don't want to see the scene. I want to see the fucking side-by-side of real life. All right, well, come on, bud. There you go. I think I got it. Yeah. Okay, check this shit out, dude. All right, so I'm going to pour a drink and take a fucking whiz.
You got to put it. Oh, you're muted, Nan. You got to put up. Oh, there we go.
I forgot. I forgot I muted myself. I can't do that. Okay. Here it goes. Oh, nice. Wouldn't you know it, it's a fucking fox. I did not plan that. It's my favorite animal. It's my spirit animal. It's my spirit. Good old watch fox is always watching me. Check this shit out. So this was in fucking... This was in the year 2000, dude. Donald Trump appears in an episode of The Simpsons. He's going down an elevator. And they drop a sign. You see how that person dropped the sign right there?
No, wait. Can you go back?
Watch. One more time.
Okay.
2015. Thank you. That's just pretty fucking weird, huh?
Yeah, that's a little fucked up, man.
A little mindfuck, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is. And you know, if you remember the Twin Towers episode where they go to, and you know, they say $9 or 11, and it says 9/11.
Oh yeah, New York. I know that.
Yeah, and you know, that used to, like, I was like, oh man, please don't talk about 9/11, please don't, because, like, you know. Shit, yeah, man.
I know. I
used to see those buildings every day, and then they were gone. All I saw was smoke. And that used to really fuck people, would say this or say that. But you got to admit, man.
Yeah, you get attached to the memory of it. Yeah.
There was, you know, now I'm far, but, you know, there was other things involved in it. Like, you know, 9/11 happened, and then my father told me he had cancer the same day. So I was just like, my mind was like, fuck.
Oh,
but if you look at fucking, what happened at the Pentagon, there's no way a plane fucking hit that. A plane could not be that low. There's no way. I don't even think they really got hit with anything. I mean, and if it did, it was like somebody shot something at it.
It was a missile disguised as a plane.
Like a drone, right? Or like a little, or is it just like a regular missile?
Yeah. It's a drone missile. Guided drone missile disguised as a plane.
Dan, if you think about it, like, there's, you know, the technology that we have and we know about, the government, and they have 20 years ahead of us. So in 2001, we didn't really know about these drones. You didn't hear about it. Like, if you saw this, remember the stealth bomber, and it looked like a boomerang? The thing that's bombing in the Gulf War, if you saw that thing in the 80s, you would swear it was an alien vehicle. You know, you'd be like, holy shit, that's a fucking UFO, you know, it's from outer space. So who knows? But I mean, there's no way, like, it, you know, mathematically and you use the physics of everything, that a fucking 747 or whatever the fuck kind of plane they said could fly that low and hit, you know, and hit into the whale.
Yeah.
But
with no fucking video footage of anything. Fuck out of here, dude. I'm so sick of this no video footage shit. As far as I'm concerned, this fucking latest attack event was the same exact type of fucking situation that 9/11 is, and they keep perpetrating the same fear tactics and the same pattern to fuck everyone up psychologically. That's why it's called a psy-op, which is a psychological operation. It's not just a fucking a Call of Duty game. Ops. It's a real fucking thing. Black operations are a real thing.
And I can look at it from another kind of point of view, is that it did happen, but this guy was an agent of the CIA or the fucking whatever, and, you know, they put him there to do that.
The fall guy, the patsy, the Lee Harvey Oswald.
Yeah. Like,
But I mean, honestly, I don't even think he existed, man. I looked up, I found the obituary for him in fucking 2013. The obituary for that guy. For the guy. Yeah. And It's like, wait, these things, I mean, they'll have, the government will have crowds come in. Oh, I'm Antifa or anti-Antifa. And they will pay their crisis actor agents to fucking come in the tens and dozens and the hundreds.
Yeah.
And then they'll incite violence themselves. And all that Black Panther shit? Are you fucking kidding me, dude? That shit's 100% for real. Martin Luther King, what happened to him? Malcolm X, hello? You might want to learn from history so you don't repeat yourself.
You know, like when Malcolm X, like people get out, like, oh, he was just this. Malcolm X, he said, I went to Mecca and there was blonde-haired, blue-eyed Muslims praying. You know, let's stop this racial separation. Bang, he's dead. After he said that. You know, like he was saying, look, it's not just whitey. You know, it's not whitey. I saw blonde-haired, blue-eyed Muslims praying at Mecca. And then all of a sudden, the guy's fucking dead. Mm. I mean, that doesn't – who's not equal in four peoples, you know? It's really not. And you know what fucks me up is, like, you know, you think about what we learned in history. Think about what we don't know, like what technology was around, what was going on that has been hidden from us. The Vatican, like, you grew up Catholic just like I did. The Vatican has a library that nobody's allowed to go into that has all kinds of shit. So you know they're hiding stuff. You know, there's stuff being hidden. You know, and if you look at the Vatican, it's a little fucking tiny – it's a country of its own.
Country inside a country.
Yeah, and I mean, that's fucked up, you know. I mean, I don't mean to disrespect my Catholic peoples or anything, but that's kind of fucked up that, you know, you have this country in a country and they have it's like the library, the Vatican Library. I heard about it, but nobody's allowed to go there. Unless you're like a chosen cardinal or fucking whatever, you know. I mean, and do you remember the one pope who was like Dracula? It's like,
dude. Yeah, yeah. No, he looked like a fucking Darth Sidious from fucking Star Wars. Yeah.
I remember Gilbert Gottfried used to go on Howard Stern and be like, "I am the Pope." He talked like Dracula.
Dude, Gilbert Gottfried's hilarious.
Oh man!
Hey, look on the bright side. Look on the bright side. It could have been much worse.
Yeah.
Like the next one will be.
You know, I mean.
You good? Look on the bright side. It could have been much worse. Like the next one will be.
Yeah.
Like, do you think it's over? This shit's a fucking video game to them.
Yeah, I know. I mean.
Let's get the high score up.
Exactly.
Good joke, dude.
Well, I remember my father.
Did you? Oh, what were you saying?
My father, he was in the army. You know, and I remember when I was a little kid, he would have to go on business trips to South America and the Middle East, and you know, he would just go on business trips there. And he said to me, little kid, he goes, son, your war is in the Middle East and it's gonna last a long time. And he never really explained anything after that, but he just goes, it's gonna be the Middle East and it's gonna be a long time. And he said, it's gonna be stuff that you're not gonna understand. And that's all he said. So I don't know what because I can't even tell you what he did for a living. He was a businessman, like, that's all I know.
Well, he was right.
And he says it's going to be these skirmishes and, you know, there's going to be people, you know, these people rising to power, being taken out of power, being put into power. And, you know, if you look at Afghanistan where they put this Hamid Karzai, he was just like a Dick Cheney guy. It's too much. Like, and I just can't wrap my head around all this stuff. So I'm not burying my head in the sand or anything. It's just that I just don't understand, like, all this, like, chaos and, like, unrest. Like, I thought, like, during, like, society, we're supposed to progress and you know, become smarter and, you know, leave
stuff behind that we've learned from the past, but it just seems to just, I mean, it seems, I remember like people say, oh, well, during the Vietnam War, there was all these protests. I'm like, the Cuban Missile Crisis. I'm like, the Vietnam War and the Cuban Missile Crisis looks like fucking Disneyland compared to what's going on now. You know?
Yeah, man, seriously.
You know, you look at the protests that would go on, and, you know, people would take over college campuses. We're going to, you know, take over the office and Abby Hoffman. And but nowadays, I mean, you know, these motherfuckers just with the cops and the Antifa and the anti-Antifa and the Trump supporters and the, you know, I remember the big deal was, oh, we David Koresh and militias and, you know, we got to get rid of them. And, you know, look where we are now. You know, like, please, what's going on? You know, I don't get it.
Mm. Yeah, it's exhausting.
But the thing is, Dan, there's nothing I can do about it, dude. You know, like, what am I going to do? Vote for a guy? Well, that doesn't, that, you know, that don't. Because how many presidents have we voted for? Oh, well, no. Well, he got the popular vote or she got the popular vote, but this guy won. And you're like, man, that's bullshit.
Yeah, that's a big joke.
Electoral college. And, well, California has more votes and Texas has more votes. And if you look at the people that have more votes than the people, like I live in Delaware. We don't have too many electoral votes. You know? New Jersey had more than, you know, because a lot more people live in New Jersey. But, I don't, you know, it just, it's so complicated. And I can't wrap my head around it. So I try not to worry about it, you know.
Yeah. I mean, that quote that I read earlier, stop focusing on, you know, the negative events and situations. So, I mean, that's the whole point of it. That's why the media drains us with these fucking endless fucking fabricated stories. And that, and we're supposed to be, like, building our own lives. And they want us to be distracted with their bullshit so we don't, so we're too drained to even create our own lives.
So we're sitting here worried, like watching the fucking MSNBC or Fox News all day going, oh my God, the president said this, he tweeted this, he did this. You know, Dick Cheney, Obama, you know, just all this nonsense that I don't understand. And I'm just like, man, you know, I won't vote in major elections. I vote, you know, for, like, you know, my state. I haven't voted for fucking president. I think the first time I ever voted was, anytime I ever voted for president, I always just voted for some, like, one of the lunatics, or I wrote, you know, Bunny or something in, because I wasn't voting for people's. I didn't vote for Bill Clinton. I didn't vote for George Bush. I didn't vote for Obama.
Good. Did you ever vote?
Oh yeah, I always vote, but I just, you know, I throw it away. You know, I just.
Oh, okay. You just vote for some random person?
Yeah, just to be a prick, you know, because I'm allowed to. Because you know, hey, if you're gonna let me vote, I'm gonna try to fuck it up. You know, I'm gonna try to cause a ruckus while I'm doing it. You know, so. But he wrote in, like, the Trailer Park Boys. He goes, I've never voted before. I registered to vote, and then. Like, he goes, I remember, like, the singer in my band, the guy didn't know his ass from his elbow. He's like, oh, man, I got to register to vote. I don't want Bush to be president. I'm like, what the fuck do you know, stupid? I'm like, you never fucking, you don't know nothing. And he's like, we can't let him in. I'm like, first of all, you could vote for this guy. You could vote for that guy. It's all the same. You know, it's already predetermined. You know, mm-hmm. What, you think our country would be any better if Hillary Clinton got elected, or, you know, yeah, shit, give me Jesse Ventura. They say The Rock is, I'll vote for The Rock. If The Rock runs for president, I'll vote for him, because he was a wrestler.
The Rock's going to be the president in 2020.
Yeah, I'll vote for The Rock, because he'll lay it the smacketh down. He likes pie.
Warm, and he likes to...
He'll whip your candy ass. So I'll vote for that.
I mean, honestly, I like to troll people, and I like to glamorize Trump and support Trump as much as I can. Well, as much as I can, because if I did as much as I can, it would cause too much of a ruckus. So I don't want to call him the most legendary president of all time just yet, because of cause too much weave. So I'll wait till I do that. But no, I mean, it's just a part of the gimmick. Just ignore that. But Candy will probably be joining us. And I'm going to try to get my other buddy, Coast, to join in real quick. But I have to go to the Google Hangout, and I him manually, so give me a second here. Ah, shit. Pressed too many buttons there. Hold on. It's good to be king. Okay. Yeah, I'm enjoying myself, man. We talked about almost every subject except for the Esalen story part two, so pretty fucking badass. I'm glad I got
it. Hey, man, I had a great time. I'm going to have to be leaving soon. I just got a message. I sent out Ms. Violence. I sent her out a package, and she's going to open it with me because I wanted to see. I sent her some fucking a lot of my old, like, stage gear and you know, she's a punk rock girl, so, and I sent her a couple special surprises.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, so, anytime you want to get out of here, just say your piece and head on down the old rusty or dusty trail.
Yeah, but Dan, listen, man, I had a great time, man. I don't think it's just ever been me and you kicking it.
Nope. There's always someone else joining.
Yeah, there's always.
And Antonio.
Yeah, Antonio was here. I wish Antonio could have jumped on. Who's the guy? He's like Australian, but he lives. He's like an older fella.
Santos Bonacci.
Yeah, well, he's one of the flat Earth in your crew. He talks about like smoking marijuana and how it like opens up like a. He's a really good dude, man. And
THP Anthony.
Okay, yeah. I was one night. I think it was like me and Felix, or me and Candy, and he came on, and we just had a really good conversation. I really enjoyed talking with him.
Yeah, I like that guy a lot. He's cool. He's got a good heart and a good brain.
Really nice guy. Really, you know, he teaches you stuff, but he listens to you. And I really enjoyed talking with him.
Yeah, he was in the chat room earlier.
And I'm super excited. Medical court next week.
Medical, what are you getting?
Medical marijuana. Which is this. Marijuana is a made-up name to make it sound evil, so they could make it illegal in the 30s.
Yep, 100% sure. Marijuana. Right, I hate so do it. I. Yep, that's 100% true.
I like Last Chance with Mary Jane.
One more time to kill the pain. I feel something creeping in, and I'm tired of this town again. All right, so here we go. Woo! Ah, man, I can't find my buddy. That sucks. Oh, maybe this is him. Pending invite? Gobbly goo. Is this really him? It does sound, probably will. Let's see here. Yeah, I got a nice buzz going here. I'm about to cook some fucking a bagel or something. Oh, what the hell? Well, Candy doesn't join and... Oh! Hey.
I miss home because the bagels down here suck and I haven't found a good pizza joint yet.
Oh,
like all the Pete, like the, it's just not good, man. They don't, I mean, you could get a good cheesesteak. You can only eat so many cheesesteaks and, you know, a year.
Yeah. Dude.
No, I'm good for 1 or 2 cheesesteaks a year because you're just like, but hey, if you like crabs, man, they got fucking great crabs down here.
I don't like fucking seafood that much.
I don't like anything that is squishy and disgusting in my mouth.
Yeah, I am not a fan of fucking seafood, but I enjoy fish. I do like fish.
You know what I like? It's like the mussels marinara, and you dip the bread. I don't like the mussels.
God, no. Oh, no. I would never eat those dirty little mussels.
Ah, these fucking Colorado pricks scoring a goal. 3-2 fucking Colorado over the Rangers. Back to the Yankee game.
Oh, dude. Oh, there's Candy. She said, fuck the Yankees.
Yeah, man, I'm a Red Sox fan.
Yeah, we know. And Boston's playing tomorrow, I think.
How you doing, Candy?
I'm great.
Can't really hear you that well, but I can hear you. I can hear you. That's all that matters.
Hold up. Let me connect my headphones. I got my Bluetooth in my car connected. That's why.
Okay, yeah, I figured.
Candy, I sent Dakota a package, and he got it today, so we're going to open it up later.
I know. I sent him one today, too. He's going to get it on Tuesday.
I sent him 27 fucking penny rolls.
Now, what exactly is he looking for?
Like, he looks for the, like, flaws. You know, like, a lot of times, like, there'll be, like, you know, pennies that here, like, say, you know, 1980. And if you have a 1980 penny with, like, the ear of Lincoln that's fucked up, or there'll be, like, a double stamp on it, it's like finding a baseball card that says, like, the wrong name, or it spells the name wrong. You know, it's like, and people pay a lot of money for this shit, apparently.
Yeah, like, the first pennies that I went and got, I found a $20 penny. So I went and spent $10 on penny. Well, really, the first time I spent $2.50 because I got 5 rolls. And then the second time I got 20. I haven't
nothing
gone through
better
those yet.
Than a $20 penny.
Well, I haven't gone through the 20. I haven't gone through the other 20 rolls I got yet. I haven't had time. So yeah, I mean, it's a 1 cent coin, and you make nine nuts.
Yeah. What a fucking crazy. Pennies and nickels are seem to be the coins that you really you can make it. You know, your profits on.
Yeah, I got 2 rolls of nickels, but I mean, it's, I'd rather.
Dude, my mom and dad have like $5,000 worth of coins.
My mom's got a lot too. She won't even let me go through them. She's being a bitch.
Collecting those coins since fucking I was born.
You know what? I love coins for some reason. Like, you know, they're just.
Coins from different countries?
Yeah, my parents had I remember they had a collection of coins because my mother went to Europe and my father, when he was in the military, would get coins. And when I was a little kid, I just used to, like, play with them and look at them. And DeCone sent me one from, let me tell you, this is fucking amazing. It's a coin. I don't know if you can see it. It's you see, it just looks like a rock or something. But it's from... Oh, fuck. What year? It's like, you know, it's like the Roman Empire this is from.
Damn.
And it's like older than anything that I've ever seen, you know? So just to be able to look at it, and I actually took it out and touched it. And, you know, it was just amazing.
The only one, the oldest one that I found was the 1944 so far.
Is it a wheat penny?
Yeah, I have 5 wheat pennies. That's it. Out of all the pennies I have. I have a 1944, 45, 46.
This is from the Roman Empire, 530 AD.
Damn.
I mean, this is just like, this has been around for fucking longer than anything I've ever seen, except for, like, mountains and trees and, you know, it's the oldest man-made thing I've ever seen.
I wonder the oldest thing I have is I was collecting fossils when I was a young kid.
Ooh.
And
dinosaur fossils.
No, I mean I used to trick my friends into thinking that they were raptor claws, because certain I would collect they're called horned coral, and these horned coral fossils are they're shaped like fucking horns, but it's coral, so it's called horned coral, but they look like fucking raptor claws.
Like this Jurassic Park shit.
Like you can get big ones. Like there's really small ones, but you can get fucking huge ones that look like the fucking raptor claws. And so I brought those into when I was a teacher's aide at the Stanley G. Falk School with the kids when I was doing my thing there in my early 20s. I told the kids if they behaved well that week that I would bring in they would all get a raptor claw as a present at the end of the week. And they were like that. I had ways of brainwashing them into good behavior, and telling them that if you were good today, that you will all play basketball and hacky sack at the end of the day. And they're like, oh, they all have to be good. I'm like, hey, and if they fuck up during the day, I'm like, dude, you fucking told me that you wouldn't be a dick, and we're gonna play fucking. It's so funny, dude. Like I would talk to these kids like a friend, and you're not really. Kind of supposed to, but that was my way of relating.
They respect you better if you do, though.
Well, and you know what, Dan? You were like the assistant teacher. You weren't like the main. Okay, everybody, do your homework. You know that's kind of like what you're supposed to be. You know, you're supposed to be like the good cop, bad cop kind of thing. You know,
and also like enforcer too. Where I mean, I learned like TCI techniques where I had to like put these kids in certain holds where it doesn't hurt them. And
but it could like stops them, yeah.
Dan, I got my tattoo.
Yeah, I mean, I've had to do that a bunch of times. I mean, mm-hmm. I can hear you. Yeah, I mean, a lot of shit has happened. I've had kids almost.
I said I got my tattoo, fool. I said I got my tattoo finally.
Well, of what? What?
The one I sent you the other day. But it was like 2 weeks ago now.
What is it of?
I don't want to say because I don't want everybody to know.
Okay. Well, you're
no. It's the. I already showed you the picture. I copied it. I copied it from Decone. Really, it's the chemical compound for THC.
Oh yeah, I saw that. Okay, I remember that. Sorry.
My buddy Jersey has that too. Like you, the only three people that I, you know, my buddy Jersey had it because he lived out in Oregon, and was working in the marijuana industry. Then came back to Jersey and he's still working. But he had, I'm like, what the fuck is that? It looks like a fucking honeycomb. Like, a chemical compound for THC. And then the cone goes, check this out. I'm like, oh shit. And then Candy goes, check this out. I'm like, oh shit.
All
right, I just have like skull and crossbones and fucking. I got the seahorse and you know my old band logo and a sea monster and the American flag with 13 stars all ripped up. Oh, and my angel on my shoulder. I don't know if you can see that, but angel on my shoulder.
He's got the fucking flat earth. He's got the flat earth dragon on his shoulder.
Yep.
Yeah, this like this right here. It's like one of those. The old-timey maps, remember, like, you know, like a Christopher Columbus map, and they would have the sea monster going in and out of the water, and the earth, yeah, like, it was just, like, flat, and that's what, it's so hard to hold my arm at the right angle so you could see it, but it's a sea monster, like, going in and out of, the, like, those old maps, like, the old, you know, and they would have, like, the
north. Yeah, we know, dude.
Yeah, and it just, pew, 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 pew.
Don't go off the edge of the flat earth.
And everybody's like, nice dragon. I'm like, it's not a dragon. It's a sea monster.
I didn't, though. I knew what it was.
It's not a dragon. It's a sea monster.
So I guess I was a flat earth guy before I ever fucking even knew about it.
That's going to be my next tattoo. I'm going to get something about flat earth. I don't know what, though, yet.
I'm done. Once they started putting tattoo fucking shops in the mall, I'm like,
why not mine in a house?
That's the only way I can do it, G.G. Allen style, is just like somebody. My buddy was supposed to give me a Wu-Tang tattoo.
Oh, God.
Dude, and we were gonna do
like a piece of, it was gonna be like a, it was gonna be like the woo te, the woo symbol. It was gonna be like a piece of Swiss cheese, but bullet holes in a piece of cheese. You know, and it was like, you know, but I you know, he just never hooked up to get it.
In the ninth grade, I had this teacher in the ninth grade. His name was Mr. Parent, and he was such a dick in class. But he was so cool in the hallway, and he was so old. He was like 75, and he was like this little bitty guy, and he would stand in the hallway with the Wu-Tang symbol with his hands like Wu-Tang, and then he got all of his shirts embroidered with the Wu-Tang symbol. It was so cool. Like,
I love the Wu, man. I fucking love the Wu-Tang Clan. I went to go see him in New Jersey, and it was supposed to be the Wu-Tang family reunion. And they all came out and did like solo stuff. Like instead of having an opening act, they all came out and did some solo stuff. So Method Man came out.
That's the only one I've seen. I saw Method Man with Limp Bizkit and all
Method
that.
Man leaves and a crowd's going, ODB, ODB, ODB. And they hear Method Man on the microphone and goes, he's not here, but if you see him, tell him we love him. And the next day he died.
Oh, shit.
It broke my heart, man. And then I
forgot he was even dead.
I cut out a picture, and you know how you can, you know, go to the craft store and you could buy those, like, it's like, I don't know, it's not like paper, but it's like plastic that you could, kind of like your driver's license where they seal it. And I sealed a picture of ODB and put it in my wallet. My girlfriend goes, you don't even have a picture of me in your wallet, but you have a picture of a N. And I was like, don't you fucking ever say that. We didn't last too long after that. You don't fucking call. You know, it was just like very racist and hateful. And I didn't like it.
Oh, wow.
I was like, I'm bitches not going to
be fucking, bitches.
You know, it's like, she goes, you don't even have a picture of me in your wallet, but you have an N. And I'm like, wow. Fuck you.
Yeah, Twitter, you filthy demon.
Well, the thing that the straw that broke the camel's back was we were watching a movie, and my buddy calls me and goes, look, we gotta go to New York and talk to the A&R from the label. I'm like, all right, I'll be over your house in 10 minutes. And she was like, why do you have to leave? We're having fun. I'm like, well, this is kind of what I do. Yeah, but we're here to get. I'm like, listen, when you met me, I was doing this. You think I'm going to fucking not do this for you?
I hate bitches like that.
You know, I was like, this is what I do. I was like, whatever.
That's like, I can't stand that. Like, if somebody was doing something when they met you, like, I can understand if you have like a mutual agreement to like, okay, we're going to better ourselves and we're going to do this together or whatever. That's one thing. But if you demand somebody to stop doing something that they were doing when you met them, who do you think you are?
I mean, I was playing in that band for 10 years before I dated this girl. And you just think I'm going to just throw 10 years of fucking hard work and sacrifice and, you know, away for your dumbass? Fuck you. Yeah. That's just, you know, I don't know.
So, hold on. It says Ryan DeCone Madison live tonight at 9 p.m. preview.
Yep.
Got a pack.
That was earlier.
No, that's okay. DeCone, me and DeCone are going to do a stream because I sent him 27 rolls of pennies. So he's going to open them. We're going to be on, we're going to do like a little coin stream. But I also sent my
phone.
I also sent my future ex-wife a package, and we're going to do that privately.
Your future ex-wife?
Yeah.
Are we talking about Lisa?
No, Miss Violence. Lisa's a foreigner. She can't even come to this country, I don't think. And I'm sure they're not going to let me go in their country.
She needs a multi-pass?
Felony charges. I mean, I never got convicted of a felony, but I have like some nasty things that I was charged with. And I was always innocent because I didn't do it. Yeah, they get a little sensitive about that up there. Like, you can't go to Canada. Like, if you have a drunk driving conviction, they won't let you across the border. You got to fucking write the government and get special permission. Like, my buddy, he had to, him and his future ex-wife went up to Canada a couple weeks ago. And, you know, they had to, because both of them were fucking arrested multiple times for crazy things. And they had to, you know, get permission from the government to go up there to, I don't know, go hunting or fishing or whatever the fuck they were doing. I don't like to murder animals, but I do like to fish, like catch and release. You catch a fish and you put them back. But unless, you know, you go blue fishing in the ocean, and they'll bite your fucking fingers off, man, those pricks. So I did that once, and I was like, never again. Just, when you pull it on the boat, the guy clubs it and kill. And I was just like, oh, that's horrible. I'm like, this fish is just out there doing its thing.
Yeah, I haven't fished in a long time.
I love fishing.
I used to love fishing, dude. I used to fish when I was a kid, and I would always make sure I'd catch the fish and put them back.
Yeah, catch and release, man.
Or if I did catch the fish, I would, you know. You eat it.
Yeah.
I always let the fish go.
Yeah, I'm catch and release. I don't want to, you know, shit.
I feel bad.
You're like, oh, shit, I'm hungry. Let me eat a sandwich. And all of a sudden, you're getting yanked by your mouth. like a tour. I'm eating a fucking... You know, I got a fucking Italian sub, and then
I've cried stepping on a fucking insect and a worm before.
You know what my sister used to do? When we lived in El Cajon, we had a lot of snails, and my sister was like evil, and she would take salt and pick up the snails and salt the snails, and it would just like
bubble. Oh, yeah.
I'm like, you're a sick fuck, man.
Yeah, that's fucked up. I did it once.
I love Bob Marley.
Bob Marley's a legend.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I was looking up because I'm a huge Bruce Springsteen fan, right? So one time.
Oh, God! I can't stand him.
Well, that's because you're not from Jersey. it's against the law not to like Bruce Springsteen.
I think we've had this conversation before. Oh, my God. I can't see how anybody likes that music.
But there was it was like from like the 70s, and it was a club called Max's Kansas City in New York, and it was Bob Marley and Bruce Springsteen, and I was just like, it just blew my mind.
Odd.
Like, and it was like Bob Marley opened up for Bruce, and I was like, that even blew my mind even more. But I can't imagine seeing Bob Marley in fucking Max's Kansas City, which is like this little tiny fucking place. And actually, where I live now in Wilmington, Delaware, Bob Marley used to live here because his mother came here to work at the Chrysler factory. And he would come here, and he worked for DuPont Chemicals as a janitor and Chrysler as a janitor. And when he came to the United States, Wilmington, Delaware would be his home base. And there's a picture of him and like one of his sons with a soccer ball in Wilmington. And every year they have a Bob Marley festival.
That's awesome. But I got to jump off here because I got 1% battery and I'm trying to charge my battery so I can work.
Okay, yeah. Candy. Thanks for hopping on.
Jump on later, man, with the Decone thing.
You know I'll be there.
Right on.
Bye.
All right, I'll see you guys. Well, I'll see you there, Candy. Thanks, obviously. Still got fucking 10 viewers straggling on here, Jokerfish.
Hi, 10 viewers.
hey, 10 everybodies.
Hey, what's going on, everybody?
that's hilarious. Yeah, so when are you hopping off here?
Probably in a couple. I gotta, I gotta do a couple things. Like, I gotta get something to eat. I haven't eaten.
Yeah, me too. I'm preheating the oven. Yeah, I've been drinking fucking gin and juice.
Oh, yeah, man.
I pulled out the big stuff today. I was like, should I get cheap vodka I pull out the big guns. I got some fucking, I got some gin.
Are you going to jump on the, with Immortal Technique? Are you going to jump on the stream?
Well, if Josh told me that he was going to let me come on, so
yeah,
most likely.
Yeah, you should, man. You really should. Like, I really don't know his music or too much about
him. Oh, yeah.
I'm just going to hang back.
Oh, I know a fuck ton about him.
You should jump on, man. You know, you really should. Because, come on, man, how often, like, how many chances are you going to get to talk to the guy? You know,
exactly.
Symbolic, you know, like, you got.
I was blown away. I was blown away by how scholarly Diabolik was, and he even researched a bunch about the flat Earth.
And you know what
my favorite conspiracy right now.
Because he said he'd like to do it again. He's like, oh, I like this. You know, I want to come on again.
Awesome, dude. That's awesome.
That would be cool. Like if we could, like, you know, every once in a while hook up with him and maybe Immortal Technique, because we got fucking. The drummer from Negative, and now he plays with Danzig. He loves the Josh's Metal Mondays, and he's like, "Yo, Victor, the guitar player for Danzig, what's his band? I forget.
Can we get Norm McDonald on too?
Well, I don't think we could get Norm.
No, sorry, Nick DiPaolo. Nick DiPaolo.
Nick DiPaolo. You know what? Fucking, I think he's like a, no, he's a Boston guy, Nick DiPaolo. I thought he was a
guy.
I don't know, man. Maybe. Maybe we could, because I know, like, Jim Florentine and his other buddy, they used to do that Eddie Trunk show, that, you know, that metal show. And they're two comedians, Florentine and.
Yeah. I can't remember the other guy.
I bet we can get them on because, you know, they're a little older than me, but, you know, I know all that Jersey shit and all that, you know, Metal Militia, because those dudes are metalheads. So
yeah,
like, kind of tap into the comedy scene and then start, you know, getting in with
shit. Well, yeah, exactly. I'm going to talk to Josh about the Nick DiPaolo thing, because I'd love to pick Nick DiPaolo's mind about Patrice O'Neill.
Oh, dude, I was
going to
sure. I've seen, you know, so much funny stuff from him. When I like to piss people off, and then you bring them back. Like when we were talking about, you know, I just – Patrice O'Neill, and there's this other fucking – I can't remember his name because I'm a little tipsy – that I love. He played – I don't know if you ever saw the show Black Jesus on Cartoon Network. It was Aaron.
I don't think so.
Oh, you got to see Black Jesus. They don't do it anymore. like Charlie Murphy was on it, and it had the father, Craig's father from Friday, like Ice Cube's father from Friday.
Yeah.
I can't remember his name, but he played Booney, and this dude is fucking hilarious. He's filthy. He'll be like, oh, you think that's fucked up? Listen to this. And he'll tell a story about, like, his wife or his girlfriend having a miscarriage and in the toilet, and he's pretending to like, they're flushing the toilet and going, bye, daddy. He goes, bye, motherfucker. I don't even know you. And, like, he's fucked out of his mind.
That's good stuff.
I think I'm gonna jump off.
Yeah, dude. Thanks for fucking shooting the shit with me. It's been a good, great hangout.
Yeah. So and, anytime, Dan, we got to do this again. And yeah, you got to definitely get on with Immortal Technique, man. You know.
Oh, I'll be prepared. I'll be prepared.
You just gotta get on with them and talk with them, because, you know, it's like, where else are you gonna get the opportunity? You know. And a lot of times these guys really they really appreciate, because the way we do stuff, it's not like your normal interview. Like, so what are your influences? You know, it's like we get into shit. We're like, yo, so did you ever suck a cock, or did you ever do this or do that? You're like, oh, my God, this is like because the dude from Typo Negative was just like, it's just like hanging out and drinking. You know, it was
exactly.
So
it was so cool to do that with Typo. Dude, absolutely, man.
Yeah, you definitely got to hop on with them and get some questions together if you want, or, you know, you know.
I have a bunch of questions already lined up. So I've never even used them yet. I just have them right next to me always.
Yeah. So I mean,
and I never even use them.
You know, so I mean, to me, like these guys, like, you know, I'm a fan of, like, you know, the old school New York hip hop and, you know, some Cali shit and whatever, but I don't like that fruity new hip hop. But these guys are the guys that are on the fucking tip right now.
The front lines.
They're the revolutionaries. They're the public enemy. They're the fucking, like, they're guys that are out there. They're not trying to, like, oh, well, we just want to make money. And, like, they'll go out there and get.
Jay-Z's trying to sign Immortal Technique.
And yeah, because he didn't, you know, he's just like, no, I don't want none of that. He goes, and these, like, this is what I respect about him, is they make a living doing this, but they don't say, well, I want the cars, the houses, the bitches, the jewelry. They don't give a shit. Like Diabolik, Immortal Technique, well, Joey Badass, like some of my crew, like my Jersey crew was in with his crew, and he's about the money.
Wait, who's Badass. That?
Joey Badass, he's a really good rapper. But one of my buddies was doing clothes, like a clothing line with him, and he screwed my buddy over for the money, and you know.
Oh man!
But it is what it is, man. You know, because what the thing was
for a couple fucking. All right, and you're blocked.
Let me talk a shit.
Just some stupid fucking pointless. He says we know who Immortal Technique is, dude. It's like, dude, we're talking about stories, dude. Shut the fuck up.
Yeah.
The end of my shit, dude. You were fine the entire time. I'm gonna fucking bandage on us.
We're gonna be talking to him. You're not.
No. <shit. laughs> Oh, that's a good one. that's awesome. And on that note, yeah, dude, thanks for joining, man. We'll definitely do this again, and I'll check out DeCone's link later. Probably so that's in like 2.5 hours.
Yeah, it'll be 9 o'clock around 9 o'clock your time.
All right, dude. Thanks for joining, Jokerfish. And
always a pleasure, Dan. I love you, brother. And you know, we'll talk soon. And namaste.
Yeah, dude. That's Jokerfish, everybody. He's a good fucking cat.
All right, everybody.
Got a lot of heart.
I'll talk to you later, Dan.
Got a lot of fucking. Later, bro. Got a lot of fucking. A lot of heart, a lot of authenticity. And that's what I like. I don't like to fucking hang around with fucking frauds. So, I've had a nice, fun time here tonight. Drinking some gin and juice. Shooting the shit with the Jokerfish. Talking some deep issues. Now that I've gotten all that out of the way, now that I've enjoyed all of that, I got to share with you the Dark Night of the Soul story, entering Chapel Perilous and then crossing the River of Tears. I got to tell you the story where I shared my video of entering the mystery. And in the Church of the Subgenius group, and I met my first cousin through Bob Dobbs, and his father's name is Bob. Praise Bob. And talked about some current news, the Vegas bullshit. Tom Petty faked his death, and now he's living on the island where they all have concerts and endless orgies under the moonlight sun. That's right, the moonlight sun. Had off some good quotes off of Facebook and Twitter. Had a nice time talking with the good folks who joined the panel, which was Candy and my other friend whose microphone wasn't working. Let's see here. Got to share the Terrence McKenna video and the Orson Welles video with Andy Kaufman. getting interviewed, Orson Welles interviewing Andy Kaufman. That was a good one. We got talked a little bit about DMT and mushrooms, brushed up. And soon I'll have my part two of the Esalen story. And that's the juicy parts. That's the scary parts. And the part that you, the parts that you won't believe that it really happened. And that's the good. I'm glad I got all of the context and the little boring details out of the way in the first story. And I'll review that very quickly. I'll upgrade your memory. And then I'll go into the Esalen story, the juicy parts, part two. And that's going to be really good. Oh, and now Wes shows up. I just go to check the comments there, and I notice Wesley Stance and Flat Earth News Talk showed up. Hey, how you doing there, Dan and Joker? Huh? Okay, Dan, I'm ready for my close-up. Juice, of course it is. It's my favorite drink. All gone. Thank you. Building a lab there in Washington. Cool. All right, well, thank you, everybody. If you could like, and your band. Hey, Hoodwink 33, your band now. So now you can create a sock account to view my live streams from now on, because you just got yourself banned and you're gone. You're gone. Was it worth saying gay? That's all it takes. Bye bye. Bye bye. I mean, I would like to keep talking and entertaining you, but I'm going to get going and take Aldo for a walk. And yeah, I'm going to take you for a walk, Bubba. Come on, come here. Come here, bud. Yeah, you want to go for a walk? Yeah, let's go for a walk. We'll go for a walk. Go for a walk. Oh, yeah, come here. You going for a walk? Yeah. Oh, come give me a hug. Oh, thanks, Bubba. Oh, thanks. Just come up and give me a hug. Oh, thank you. Oh, you're so comfy and warm and loving. Yeah. Let's go for a walk, bud. Go.
All right. Lead the way.
Yep. All right, everybody. That's super fun time. Something from this. I certainly did. It's how to relax and have a good time.
You ready, Bubba? You ready? Come on. You want to go for a walk? Yeah.
You got to bark? You speak? You want to speak? Speak. Speak. Hey, come here. Bark. Speak. Sound good? Sound good? Sound good? Sound good? Sound good? Come on, do it. Sound good? Do it. Sound good? Sound good? Sound good? Do it. Do it. Good, do it. Sound good? Wanna go for a walk? Sound good? Sound good. Sound good. That's a good boy. You go for a walk? Okay, let's go, bud. Good boy. See you later, everybody.